presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to buckle up, Georgia, as we welcome you to Westlake Stadium in Atlanta. Another Football Friday in Georgia, big north-south battle tonight as AAA 6th-ranked Crisp County Cougars have traveled north from Cordele to take on 7A powerhouse Westlake Lions. And good evening. I'm Matt Stewart, joined by former Auburn Tigers All-American, NFL first-round draft pick, and 15-year pro Wayne Gandy. And Wayne, I know what folks are thinking. They're thinking 3A versus 7A. There's just no way. But both of these teams are chock-full of college football talent. Crisp has a history of knocking off 7A teams, and Westlake's trying to bounce back from a tough 21-17 loss to number 3 North Cobb in their season opener.
And the big question in these kind of games when you're moving up from 3A to 7A to play is, can your great talent stand up the whole game against the depth of Westlake? Crisp County has a lot of great players, but they're going both ways.
Indeed they are. Let's start with Westlake, led by first-year head coach Rico Zachary. He's back in high school after 3 years on the staff at Kennesaw State. He inherits a 4-year starter at quarterback, R.J. Johnson, committed to Toledo.
It's the same R.J. Johnson that you saw 4 years ago. He's playing the same position, and he's playing it at a high level. They count on him to make plays. Only 11 interceptions on his career. He's learning a new offense. Watch for him as the season go on to become a dynamic star in this system.
When R.J.'s not throwing the ball, he's handed it off to Jaden Thomas, who rushed for 1,100 yards last season.
Only 175, 5'9", but he has a big game, and they count on him with this young offensive line to control the game and keep him into it until this offensive system starts working with the pass game.
Defensive side of the ball, the highest-rated prospect in the game, Westlake 4-star corner and Clemson commit, Avion Terrell.
Why not go to Clemson? That's what took your brother to the pros, A.J. Terrell, Atlanta Falcons first-round pick in 2020, and his younger brother is just as dynamic. What a playmaker on offense, down the field, a deep threat, and you know on as a corner, he's aggressive. He will jump routes for interceptions.
All right, Wayne, let's talk about Crisp County. They, too, have a first-year head coach in Lawrence Smith, promoted from offensive coordinator to replace his buddy and head coach, Miguel Patrick, who got a job on the Ohio State staff, believe it or not. 60-17, the team he inherits over the last 6 years. He also inherits a 3-star quarterback, Ahmad A.J. Brown. But this is a 3-star safety who starts both ways and committed to Ole Miss.
A.J. Brown, what a player he is. Starting at safety, you have to go to high school where you start safety and start at quarterback. But what a dynamic athlete, the best athlete on the field for this team. They count on him. If he's going to rest, he's going to be at the quarterback position, but they count on him on both sides of the ball to make plays.
Up front, Crisp has one of the best junior offensive linemen in the state, 4-star Barry Walker, who already has 18 offers.
6'6", 300 pounds, put me in the mind of an old teammate of mine, Orlando Pace, that slender basketball frame with great feet. And what his coach loves the most about him, he's becoming a big-time finisher in the run game.
Defensive side of the ball for the Cougars, linebacker Julian Fox. He has 11 offers, over 180 career tackles.
All the intangibles as a linebacker, speed, size, and his coach says he's even a greater player and person. He's counted on to set the tempo, the hardest-working player on this team, and they need him in that tempo on defense.
So this is going to be a fun one. It's the Cougars and the Lions. Let's bring in the third member of our team, John Nelson, who's standing by at Westlake Stadium.
Greetings, Matt. Good evening, you. Good evening, Wayne. Good evening to all of you, however you are accessing us, large device or small. Here at the lake, the guy pacing nervously over my left shoulder is Rico Zachary. We welcome him back to the high school ranks, and he even has ties to the folks across the hall. 15 years ago, he was an assistant down at Crisp when Tommy Walburn was the head coach. You look at it now, and he's taken programs like Central Carroll and Villarica from just missing the playoffs to deep runs in the playoffs. Now he has that same self-expectation level when it comes to life here at Westlake. He wasn't really looking to dive back into the college ranks, but when his wife was looking for homes on this side of town, it kind of gravitated toward an opening when Bobby May went to Kell. Opening here, Rico Zachary becomes a high school coach all over again. That's the early story here from Westlake. Hannah Gooden, what's going on at 260 14th?
Thanks, Sean. Great story on Rico, and should be a good one at the Lions Den tonight. We're doing something new this season and streaming a second game brought to you by Breda Pest Management. That game will feature the Callaway Cavaliers versus the Cedartown Bulldogs. You can watch it live right now. Download the GPB Sports app by scanning the QR code right there on your screen. You can also catch it online at gpb.org/sports. And don't forget to stick around after the game for the post-game show, where we check in with coaches all around the state. Matt, take it away.
All right, thank you, Hannah. Like we say, when it's over, it isn't over. Stick around for Hannah and Nelly and that postgame show. And speaking of the QR code, you watching the game tonight, go to that QR code right there on your screen right now, scan it, and pick the winner of tonight's game. Of course, Chris or Westlake, and tell us who you think's going to win this battle. So ready for the opening kickoff, and the opening kickoff is brought to you by Buckle Up Georgia. Buckle Up Georgia, seatbelts save lives. So Westlake won the opening toss. They have deferred. That means we will see Crisp County on offense to start this game. Trey Walker and Deshaun Fed standing deep for the Cougars. And we are underway in Atlanta. Ball's gonna go out of bounds at the 10-yard line. So Crisp will start at the 35-yard line.
And right there, Matt, you have to wonder, is that the fear Trey Walker brings as a return man? Two big returns last week.
On the kicking team. The ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
Two big returns last week, and the kicking came, and right there causing a penalty, which gives them great field position to start off.
And there is Ahmad A.J. Brown, 6'1", 195 senior, two-way starter, also the starter at free safety. Minimal stats last week in their 17-6 season opening win against Dooley County, throwing for just 42 yards, 3 of 10 passing, 5 for 36 in the rushing department. And Samaj Chatfield will line up behind him. Or they're gonna actually make him kick it over. I thought we were gonna line up at the 35-yard line and do business, so they have that option. Or did they not have a penalty? Because they're putting the ball at the, yeah, so they're backing them up 5 yards and making them kick it again.
Coach Smith wanted the ball early into Walker's hand, give him a chance to return, maybe get a little better field position, but that's the kind of player he is back there returning balls.
Omar Camaro, 5'11", 220 junior, set to kick it off for the Lions again. And this one's gonna come down returnable at the 8-yard line. And that's Brown, hit at the 15, turns the corner, out of bounds about the 22 or 23. So that is where Crisp County will start on offense. So the decision to make him kick again didn't pay off for it.
And that's the kind of player he is. You're starting quarterback, returning kicks, and we know what he can do at the safety position. They count on him to make plays and get the ball in many ways, starting off the game with a solid return. Interesting decision, as you said, Matt, by Coach Lawrence Smith.
Yeah, should have just taken the penalty and had the ball at the 35, but hindsight's 20-20. And now the Cougars go on offense. They gained only 196 yards of offense last week in their victory over Dooley County. In fact, they were outgained 261-96.
Watch for this offensive line as it tries to jail up front. A lot of big bodies try to take this game over early.
So Samaj Chatfield, who rushed for 103 yards last week against Dooley, lines up in the backfield next to Brown. First handoff of the game and no gain. Maybe a yard on the play as we take a look at the starting lineups. It's brought to you by Regions. Get back in the game with Regions Bank. And there's big Barry Walker at the left tackle position. Then you go Barron, he's a big dude too. 6'2", 325, Williams, Oliver, and Lawton across the rest of the line. Lawton's a two-way starter, by the way. There's Chatfield, the running back. Then you go Walker, Smith, Fed, and Troutman, the tight end.
Early shifting right there by Westlake. Watch for them to do a lot of movements. This great secondary. They take a lot of chances and play aggressive up in that front seven.
Second down and two. Bad snap. Brown gets on top of it back at the 14-yard line, and that will be a big loss for Crisp.
Ball really never got in the air, rolling all the way back to the quarterback. You can see for a slight second there, A.J. Brown thought about picking it up, and then he did the smart thing. A lot of pressure on him just to cover up the ball.
11-yard loss on the play.
Great job so far in the dangerous situation here for Brown at quarterback. Not only do they have Terrell over there at corner, but Mosby and these young corners, dangerous throwing the ball in this situation.
And Mosby's a prospect too, Wayne. He has six offers from Ole Miss, Louisville, Duke, and others.
On the offense, 5-yard penalty, we play third down.
Bernard Jones, our referee tonight. There's a look at the rest of the officiating crew working this game at Westlake High School.
And in this down and distance, you just want to get your punter some room right down. Watch for this offense. Maybe a screen, quarterback draw, just something safe. Get out. It's third and 27. There's really no third and 27 play in these type situations.
Heavy rush. Brown going to go down at the 1-yard line. Quarterback sack for the Lions.
Ahmad Johnson, the Mike backer, coming in untouched there. It's number 7. Barreling down on Brown here. Big hole in the middle. Just no one there to pick him up. And this is what I was referring to in these kind of plays. Just really want to run a quarterback sneak or something, but right there, unblocked, two gentlemen right in the face of A.J. Brown.
So not only did Chris make the wrong decision on the kickoff return, not taking the penalty, they lost 23 yards on the drive, and now they're kicking out of the back of their end zone. They got a great kicker in David Mitchell, but he's standing on that back line. Gets it out of there, a line drive kick. It's going to hit at the 36, take a bounce and field it at the 50-yard line. Great return opportunity. And Avion Terrell inside the 25-yard line.
Great job there by Avion Terrell getting the ball, getting upfield. As you can see, trying to use that speed to make that defense have to cover him, and that's the kind of dynamic player he is. He's in the field right now, must be a little injured.
Saw Avion Terrell committed to Clemson, over 21 plus offers, including Auburn, ranked the number 28 cornerback in the nation. And there's R.J. Johnson, over 7,000 yards passing in his career, over 500 yards rushing, 58 touchdown passes, 59 with the one he threw last week against North Cobb. And there's Jaden Thomas. Jaden Thomas down to the 15-yard line.
What a player he is. Quick cut right there, as you can see. Nice job on that left side, caving it down, getting out of the tackle there of Julian Fox. That's the speed we're talking about. As we said, only 175, but he runs at about 210, 215, and hits the line quick.
So second down and one. Ball at the 15 after a 9-yard pickup for Jaden Thomas on his first carry. Keeper now for Johnson. First down. Johnson steps out of bounds just shy of the 7-yard line. Penalty flags down on the field.
Nice read here by R.J. Johnson. Little read option. Watching the end the whole time. That's a little limp right there as he comes back to the huddle. Not sure.
I believe, Wayne, we have a holding on this play. We'll erase an 8-yard run.
Holding on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of foul. Replay.
Yeah. Wayne, this is a brand new offensive line. They have only one returning starter from last year, and that's the sophomore left tackle, Juan Gaston, who rolls in at 6'8", 348.
Coach Zachary talked about he's doing a little shuffling there, especially on that right side with Furbush and Stewart. He's looking for the best five up front. He's still in that search, but they all have a lot of size. And the one thing he says is they give a lot of effort up there. And sometimes as the quarterback or running back is bouncing out as a tackle, you pull that hand to the outside and pull a little shoulder.
Second down and 7 inside the 10. Touchdown, Westlake.
Nice protection, nice pocket to throw from for R.J. Johnson. Throwing the quick strike there.
Ahmad Butler, the tight end, with the 20-yard touchdown reception.
Looking him down the whole way, saw it from the snap, and then just bullying his way into the end zone as the big tight end for the score.
So PA attempt by Omar Kamara. The holder is James Banks, and the kick is no good. 20-yard touchdown pass from R.J. Johnson to Ahmad Johnson. 60th touchdown pass of R.J. Johnson's career.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to be safe on every trip. Buckle up, Georgia.
Sweetheart, please don't forget to wear your seatbelt.
I got it, Mom. It's a really nice day, living in the right space. Breathing your face got me feeling some kind of
way. In the blink of an eye, so many tomorrows can disappear. Buckle up for your future. Every trip, every time. A message from the Governor's Office of Highway Safety. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is about all Georgians standing together for substance abuse prevention. Celebrate life. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
Time for the $1,500 donation from our friends from Cigna to our friends at Westlake. Hi, we have a lot of folks here to celebrate here on Football Fridays in Georgia. Hanging out with us, the athletic director at Westlake, Carl Green. Coach, thanks for being a great partner to GPB all week long and to Football Fridays all season long.
Thank y'all for having us, man. We definitely appreciate y'all coming out for the second time in a row. Got our Chili's out here that's going to represent for us tonight.
They are most certainly doing that. Great to see our friends from Westlake, the $1,500 donation from our friends from Cigna. Football Fridays in Georgia continues after this.
So a 6-0 lead for Westlake. Our scoring drive brought to you by the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. It was a 24-yard drive, three plays, and the 20-yard touchdown pass from R.J. Johnson to Ahmad Butler, the tight end. PAT was no good, but a 6-0 lead and a great start for Westlake. Both drives started at the 24. Crisp started at their own 24, went backwards 23 yards. Westlake started at the Crisp 24 and scored in three plays.
Beautiful read there by the quarterback, R.J. Johnson. Little post route there by Butler and hitting him right in stride to give him the ability to make some people miss and run over the safety to get into the end zone.
So the kickoff going to be coming down at the 1-yard line and returnable. This is Chatfield, and Chatfield gets stopped at about the 12-yard line. So once again, very poor field position for Crisp County. Let's take a look at the keys to the game. It's brought to you by Breda Pest Management, official pest control of high school football.
This Crisp County offense, you got to produce in the run game. This defense is too dynamic in the secondary to try to get down the field with the big play. You got to get it with the legs of the running back. And on defense for Westlake, it's all about Coach Zachary and effort for him. He talks about playing hard, and those are the kind of personnel people he put over there to play hard. They also are talented on that side of the ball.
Yeah, he told us, if you don't have a high motor, you can't play for us. If you can't take contact, you can't play for us. They've come out swinging here early, just a 9-yard return for Crisp County. Let's see if they can get some offense going. They're already down a touchdown. Chatfield, not a lot of running room for Chatfield. He gets dropped by Ahmad Johnson, the Mike linebacker, short game.
And early on, you can see this Westlake defense. And this secondary, a linebacker comes up into the line or comes out on the end of the line. They're coming. They're not backing up. They have that kind of confidence in their second, in their back half, that they can play man-to-man, and they're going to bring a lot of pressure.
So second down and 9. Run by Brown, and Brown up to about the 17-yard line. We'll take a look at the Regions Bank starting lineup for Westlake on defense. Jackson, Holloman, Peters, and Smith up front. Then you've got Johnson and Amos, the linebackers, and Peterson, the nickelback. And in the secondary, Mosby, Washington Hines, and, of course, Avion Terrell.
Nice job there by Brown, getting upfield, a lot of pressure in his face. He's going to have to make plays and use that athletic ability to break some tackles, as you saw on that last run.
Third down and four. They need a first down. Not going to get it. Another quarterback sack for the Lions. John Betts, the junior Rhino, that's a defensive end position, comes in untouched.
And the scary thing about this, if you're Chris County, is generally there's a hat for a hat right now. Westlake is coming clean right there. Miscommunication by the left guard on the block. Going inside is John Betts, getting to the quarterback clean. Nice job of getting that kind of guy in A.J. Brown down on the ground by yourself.
So once again, David Mitchell has to punt out of his own end zone. Mitchell's been offered by Southeast Missouri State. Nearly got the block there. It's also been offered by Warner. It hits at the 45, and Terrell waits to pick it up. Then goes right between the defenders and spins out of a tackle. And Avion Terrell still on his feet, finally driven out of bounds at the 30-yard line.
Nice job by Avion Terrell, fielding the ball, doing a little Deion Sanders, baiting the coverage team, kind of waiting to the last moment to pick up the ball. And now I'm just going to show you effort and the athletic talent right there. Big time stiff arm to get another 2 or 3 yards. Right there you can see in complete control of when he was going to pick up that ball, trying to sucker the coverage team out of their lanes. Nice turn. Nice return there by him. Already showing you what kind of talent is headed up to Clemson.
45-yard kick, 25-yard return, first and 10 from the 29-yard line. Going to the air, right across the middle to Butler again. Ahmad Butler with his second catch of this first quarter.
Nice read again by R.J. Johnson, similar to the play. Almost exactly the same play they just scored on. Little post route, get the ball out, and what a big body Ahmad Butler is at tight end. As you can see, second catch and still making safeties pay for trying to bring him down.
That was a 14-yard pickup for Butler. It's first and 10 from the 16-yard line. Thomas bulls his way down to the six. Wayne, let's take a look at the keys to the game. Brought to you by Breda Pest Management, official pest control of high school football when Westlake has the ball.
Westlake offense, don't beat yourself. As you can see, when they execute, it's a beautiful thing to watch. R.J. Johnson in complete control right now in this game. Don't beat yourself. And for Chris County in this defense, not a lot of size. They play on athletic ability, quickness of getting off the block. And right now, they're going to have to bend back and try to stop this run game.
Second and five, complete out on the edge to Jabari Jones. And that's going to be first and goal to go for Westlake. Or was that 19? If it was 19, it was Zion Williams. No, it was Jabari Jones, number 12.
R.J. Johnson reading quickly, read option, get the ball out your hand. Zion Williams, love when you see these kind of plays by your receivers. Don't try to find a body. Just get upfield, get what you can. What a positive play there on first down.
First and goal to go inside the five. Thomas going to get stonewalled at the line of scrimmage. For the first time, the defense for Crisp County rises up. That was Julian Fox with the tackle.
And it's going to take that kind of effort for this defense, this Cougar defense. They're going to have to get multiple bodies to the ball, rally, get off of this big offensive line up front. Westlake starting with the big left tackle over there, Gatson, coming in at about 350 pounds. They cannot just continue to let this line lay on them and pound and push on them. is going to wear him down as this game goes on.
Thomas has three carries for 14 yards here in the first quarter. It's second down and goal.
R.J. Johnson operating this offense. You can see a lot of communication. He knows where he wants to go with the ball.
Jane Thomas gets into the end zone, but there is a flag down on the field. So we'll check to see if the touchdown stands or not.
Five men in the backfield. 5 yard penalty. Replay, second down.
Like you have an illegal procedure. Too many people in the backfield. Someone not up on the line. Looked like where the call was. Maybe it was the receiver not up on the ball at the time of the snap.
So that's going to back him up to the 8 yard line.
Chris County, keep your eye on R.J. Johnson. He's one of those sneaky runners, as you alluded to, Matt. Has had when he needed to run the ball, put some yardage up running. Can't take your eye off him in these situations on these read zones.
He's rushed for 11 touchdowns in his career. Instead, passes the ball complete to Thomas, who sheds the tackle and gets into the end zone for another Westlake touchdown.
We talked about R.J. Johnson and his coach saying that he's trying to learn this offense. I can't tell that he doesn't know it right now. Making quick, early reads. Has man-to-man out on Thomas and just breaking the tackle. There is the little man, as we talked about, with the big game, getting into the end zone.
And you are exactly right, Wayne, when you said he runs like he's 220.
Powerful right here, going with the little fake action.
And the two-point conversion try out of the back of the end zone. So the score will remain 12-0. But Westlake has jumped on Crisp County here in Atlanta. 12-0 lead late in the first quarter.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by Regions Bank. Get back in the game with Regions Bank.
At Regions Bank, we're here to listen to your needs, and we'll customize a plan to help you reach your financial goals. Our service to Georgia goes beyond banking to creating more inclusive prosperity in our communities. From education to financial wellness to economic development, we're working to level the playing field so more people can succeed and our communities can thrive.
Half of the nation's opioid overdoses happen right at home because people don't understand the dangers of taking an Oxy or Perc with a glass of alcohol for stress or to sleep. Learn how to protect your family from opioid overdose at opioidresponse.info.
When you work on your own terms, every day feels like Friday. That's why at Friday Health Plans, we provide health insurance for professionals who do just that. Independents, freedom seekers, those who follow their own career path, even if it doesn't come with a company health plan. Open enrollment for 2023 health insurance starts November 1st. Friday Health Plans, for people who buy their own health insurance.
Welcome back to the lake. 3:15 and a half to go for the first quarter. You see Westlake, they're in study hall right now. Our second screen tonight is in Cedartown. Late first quarter, Cedartown has the touchdown on the board. They are leading the Cavaliers of Callaway by the score of 7-0. You can go to that game at gpb.org. You can have both games up however you want to watch them all night long. Our live look-in brought to you by our friends at Breda Pest Management, the official pest control of high school football. So Cedartown and Westlake, two screens tonight. 3:15 and a half to go for the first. Two quick scores on the board for Westlake. Matt and Wayne, take it away.
That's right, Nelly. Options. We believe in giving the people options. Westlake, 12-0 lead on Crisp County. They've got negative 24 yards on 5 plays. Westlake has 2 touchdowns on 9 plays.
Very well executed offense so far for Westlake, and the defense is just being aggressive with Crisp County, not giving them any room to make plays.
Ball is bobbled at the goal line, and they're going to rule that a touchback. By the way, the scoring drive you just saw there, 6 plays and 29 yards presented by the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. So they've had 2 touchdown drives, Wayne, of 24 yards and 29 yards. You just can't live like that.
And you got to tip your hat to that defense, pinning this Chris County offense, not letting them get any room, no big plays in the backfield, play after play. And the offense is coming out with a lot of energy and executing and doing what you want to do when you're playing a defensive game. Close out the drives with touchdowns.
Well, A.J. Brown has not been able to get anything going so far. He's going to start at the 20-yard line again.
Positive first downs. That's what Chris County and this offense has to come out and start trying to do. Get just 4 or 5 yards on first down to take some of the pressure off of A.J. Brown.
And Brown back starting again at quarterback. He was a starter his sophomore year. They used him primarily at wide receiver and running back last year.
5-yard penalty. Replay first down.
They can't get out of their own way right now. There's Lawrence Smith, first-year head coach, offensive coordinator last year for the team that got to the quarterfinals before losing to Cedar Grove. And he, of course, coached at Cedar Grove along with Miguel Patrick and Jimmy Smith. Both those guys were promoted to college coaching jobs.
And he has to be frustrated right now. Head coach that was your offensive coordinator, and your offense is just beating itself in so many ways.
Brown rolling and going to step out of bounds just a couple of yards on the play. And a flag goes out. Might have had contact with him out of bounds.
Always tough as a defender of when to pull up in these situations. You hustling to the ball. The quarterback is kind of giving you this idea he's going out of bounds, but is he really? And right there, just being a little too aggressive on the corner, picking up the penalty.
Yeah, I mean, you got to take it all the way to the sideline because you never know when he's going to cut up field.
Especially when you have an athlete like A.J. Brown right there.
Yeah, just, that's a late hit.
Just a late hit there by Ahmad Johnson. 3 yards
after
out of bounds.
Late hit on the defense. 15-yard penalty, which will result in a first down.
Well, perhaps that'll be the spark that this Crisp County offense needs.
And that's one of those plays where the defender has ran about 30 yards and has decided in his mind, you know, I'm hit somebody today.
I ran too far not to hit anybody, right? So that brings the ball out to the 31-yard line, first and 10. Third penalty on Westlake. You saw Rico Zachary looking at Ahmad Johnson as Mike linebacker and pointing at his head. Use your head here.
They're having an issue with the down marker. It was reading third down, and it should read first in this situation.
Crisp 1-0, 17-6 season opening victory over County up rival Dooley County, the county north of them. A lot of family, friends, cousins kind of battle. It was a tougher game than a lot of people might have anticipated. Caught in the backfield for a loss. Nothing doing right there.
A lot of bodies to the ball. Holloman, number 50, right there on the scene to bring pressure. And you can see this Westlake defense. It's 7-8 bodies in the box. They're going to challenge this Crisp County offense and A.J. Brown to throw the ball, and they have the secondary to do it. They have no issue with Mosley and Terrell of playing man-to-man out on the corners.
Absolutely.
And bringing pressure.
Those guys are out there on an island, and that's the way they like it. Second down and 13. Brown trying to set up a screen to Chatfield, who dropped it. It's going to be third down.
Christian Peterson, Sam Backer sniffing that out, even with a completed pass there to Chatfield. Most likely was going to be a play for a loss. And you just look at the body position right now, at least in this quarter of Chris County and his offense. They're kind of down, and somewhere someone is going to have to bring some energy.
Yeah, Wayne, this is one of those games where it seems like Westlake's playing with like 14 or 15 guys on defense.
And
you only have 11. That's the way it seems. They are all over the place right now.
No real tempo, and that's just cause because they're bringing pressure off the edge, up the middle, once again right here.
Another quarterback sack, the third of the quarter, as Ahmad Johnson gets to the quarterback for the second time in this game.
And nice job coming off the edge here, number seven. You left of your screen, getting rid of Chatfield, who's a pretty good blitz linebacker pickup guy from the backfield. But it's just a new tempo, better tempo, higher tempo for this Lions defense right now than Chris County can handle.
You see Ahmad Johnson, he's got six offers, including East Carolina, Middle Tennessee, and Toledo. Second-year starter. He was actually a converted wide receiver.
Which we talked about, typically receivers don't move to Mike linebacker, middle linebacker. They typically move to safety or corner. And right there, you see how he's playing with a lot of heat.
Timeout. Chris County, their first use timeout of the half. Timeout.
So 1:23 to play in this first quarter. It has been all Westlake as Crisp is unable to do anything with the speed of this Westlake defense right now. Let's take a look at the team resume for Crisp County. It's brought to you by DBHDD. Win by learning about safe usage of prescription opioids. 2019 finalists lost to Cedar Grove, 2016 and 2020 semifinalists, 2021 quarterfinalists. In fact, they played Cedar Grove the last 3 years of the playoffs, beat them once. They've won the region 5 of the last 6 years. Notable alumni, Quay Walker, now a rookie with the Green Bay Packers, starred with the Georgia Bulldogs National Championship team, and Tree Rollins, the former Atlanta Hawk.
Big Tree went to Chris. I did not know that from Chris County.
Punt by Mitchell out of there, coming down at the 36. Avion Terrell, let's see if he scoops it up. Nope, going to run away from it this time. And the ball's going to roll dead at the 49-yard line. So this will be the worst field position for Westlake so far in this game. And it's still on the opposition side of the 50-yard line.
And now this defense, pick a name for Westlake. They are right now in this first quarter the player of the game. They're not giving this offense any room other than the personal foul. No real yards gained in any of the first three drives for the Cougars offense.
Johnson is 4 for 4 for 49 yards so far in this game. Tight ends going from one side to the other on first and 10. And Jaden Thomas got stopped behind the line of scrimmage. Jamarian Troutman got the ball and got the tackler and knocked him down. As we take a look at the starting lineups for Regions, it's get back in the game with Regions Bank. You got Gaston up front, the big kid at 6'8", 348, just a sophomore, son of the former Georgia Tech basketball star by the same name. And then you go Barrington, Chavantes, Furbush, and Stewart up front. And here are your guys that get the ball. Thomas, Smith, Williams, Jones, and Butler, who's already got a touchdown catch in this game. Heavy rush. R.J. Johnson gets away with it and going to step out of bounds, taking a loss back at the 49-yard line.
Nice job of getting out of that pressure there by R.J. Johnson, being a little aggressive on this set of downs as Chris County coming right up the middle. Unblocked right there. Spin out of the tackle for R.J. Johnson, showing you some of that athletic ability. 6'2", 200, big quarterback. First, third, and long we've seen for this Westlake offense.
Yeah, R.J. is 6'2", 200 pounds, a senior. That was Troutman who was coming up the middle. Late in the first quarter, 28 seconds to go in the period. Johnson to the far side. It's caught. That'll be a first down and more. Inside the 30. Inside the 10. And Ahmad Butler, the tight end, with his third catch of the quarter. 47 yards on the play.
Good find here by Johnson. Once again, finding his target tonight, which is Ahmad Butler. This time out by the sideline. Good block there by the receiver. James Banks was the key block to get him free to get upfield. What a first quarter he's having is Ahmad Butler.
Three catches in the quarter for Butler and a touchdown. Jaden Thomas stonewalled at the line of scrimmage. Amir Dwight making that tackle for the Cougars on the final play of the first quarter. But it's been all Westlake. 12-0 lead after 12 minutes, and they're threatening to score again. Two touchdowns up as we head to the second quarter.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by Cigna. Together all the way. Cigna is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna's mission is to improve the health, well-being, and peace of mind of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is about all Georgians standing together for substance abuse prevention. Celebrate life. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
Hey guys, it's time to reveal what I'm doing after graduation. We got my cupcakes and we got my schools. Let's just do it. Cupcakes aren't really my thing, and neither is going to a four-year college. Instead, I'm getting paid $18 an hour to train as a commercial plumber. There's a ton of other trades, like electrical and carpentry, where you can make great money, live a great lifestyle with little to no debt, and even be your own boss.
Start of the second quarter, Westlake leading Crisp County 12-0. After 12 minutes to play, Matt Stewart, Wayne Gandy, Anna Gooden, and John Nelson. And the Lions threatening to score again as we begin this second period.
Great execution on all three drives by this offense. R.J. Johnson, Ahmad Butler having a big first quarter. And now on their third possession, primed to go in the end zone for their third touchdown.
Yeah, Butler, three catches for 81 yards in the first quarter. Hand off Jaden Thomas. He's in to score, and it's 18-0 Westlake. Thomas with his second touchdown of the night.
Nice job by Thomas. Little pause on this run. He's been hitting the line quick all night long here. Little draw action, good blocking up front, and nearly a walk-in untouched there for Jaden Thompson, who's also having an early big game for this Westlake offense.
They'll go for the single point right here, and it's going to be up and good, and a 19-0 lead for Westlake. Here's another look at that touchdown by Jaden Thomas, his second of the night.
Big pull there by the left guard with the kick out. Sekou Peters, nice read, nice vision there by Jaden Thomas. And as we talked about in those situations, typically you put a bigger back in when you're in the goal line, but he runs with that power fullback kind of style at 5'9", 175.
Scoring drive is brought to you by the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. It's five plays, 49 yards, and takes them only 77 seconds. So what can Crisp County do here?
It's one of those games right now where you just have to play one play at a time. And as I talked about, try if your coach Smith start having positive first downs. You can tell this Westlake defense, they're playing with pressure, they're playing with speed. You got to start maybe getting the ball out, some screens, some balls out on the edge, make them have to sprint out, rush out to the end, play on the edges a little more. Right now, working the middle of the field is not working for this Cougar offense.
You see that? Negative 19 yards to Westlake's 117 after 12 minutes and 5 seconds. So Kamara set to kick off again. This one's going to go out of bounds. Let's see if they take it at the 35 this time.
Something tells me they will at this time. Don't want to start back. Still having some discussion.
Illegal kick out of bounds on the kicking team. 5-yard penalty, re-kick.
Gonna make him kick again.
Lawrence Smith taking a gamble again, trusting his special teams. As we talked about last week, they had two big kickoff returns so far. Haven't been able to get the ball over to 25 when they've tried.
Four penalties on Westlake for 30 yards. Kick gonna land in the middle of the field and picked up at the 21-yard line. And down immediately by Trey Walker. About a 5 or 6 yard return, not a whole lot doing right there. And again, they would have been better off taking the ball at the 35.
And the first time we've seen Trey Walker return one of the kickoffs since he had a big game last week. But you got to take the field. You got to start playing the game as though it's 0-0 and start trying to have some positive first plays here on the replay. Nice job getting up the field, but look at the effort and energy getting to the ball quickly is this Westlake coverage team.
Saw Bryson Oliver on that kick coverage for the Lions as A.J. Brown goes back out there. So let's see if Brown can get something going here. 5 carries, minus 17 yards for Brown in this game. Hit in the backfield, nothing doing. Another TFL for that Westlake defense.
Number 42, Dallas Hooks, coming from that tackle position. Time and time again so far in this game, somebody's in the backfield here just reading the block, coming in between the zone block there is Dallas Hooks. And that's been the key to this defense. They're playing on Chris County's side of the ball, and they're just not having any success early in downs and putting this offense in a bad situation, as you can see right there, Terrell coming off the corner, showing a little corner blitz.
Second down and 12, more negative yardage for Crisp County. Swing the ball out there to Walker, and Trey Walker is going to take a loss.
This Westlake defense. A luxury you can have, especially on the high school level, and really no matter what level you're on, and you can have a secondary that you can trust, that you can continue to switch it up and bring pressure, as you just saw Avian Terrell coming with the corner blitz, good tackling out on the edges, and it's 3rd and 14, a situation that this offense for the Cougars is just not meant to make.
Bringing pressure again, and Brown scrambling, trying to get around the edge, and going to be hit at the 25-yard line and knocked out of bounds. Wow, what a hit by Demarius Hines, the Bandit safety.
And that's the kind of effort you're going to have to. A.J. Brown is a big-time Power 5 talent. Getting outside of the contain. Watch number 6 coming to your screen. And for an old school guy like me, this is what they used to call football around the world. Big hit, clean hit in the field of play, not in the head, knocking A.J. Brown out of bounds.
Fourth down, fourth punt now for David Mitchell.
This Chris County offense has to go to the sideline. Coach Smith is going to have to dial up something in his play calling. Cut down on this pressure that Westlake is bringing.
Avion Terrell shedding and slipping tackles all the way down to the 33-yard line. Grabs his helmet. Hopefully he's okay. But you can see how dynamic Avion Terrell is with the ball in his hands in an open field. Avion Terrell, the 4-star commit to the Clemson Tigers, dynamic in the kick return game tonight.
Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. Celebrate life. Live drug-free. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is about all Georgians standing together for substance abuse prevention. Celebrate life. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
In lively towns and peaceful rural areas, Georgia's electric membership cooperatives are on a mission to provide a different kind of electricity. Our not-for-profit, member-owned EMCs are focused on making life better for members. At private residences, farms, and thriving businesses, we work for you. Generating safe, reliable, affordable electricity, giving back to local programs, serving our members to make life brighter. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
At Regions Bank, we're here to listen to your needs, and we'll customize a plan to help you reach your financial goals. Our service to Georgia goes beyond banking to creating more inclusive prosperity in our communities. From education to financial wellness to economic development, we're working to level the playing field so more people can succeed and our communities can thrive.
Welcome back to Westlake. 9:05 to go first half. Dominant first half so far by the Lions, leading 19-0. Reminder that this is a two-screen experience for you all season long. Not just the action going on here at the Lions Den, but we can take you to Cedartown tonight, where Cedartown is taking on Callaway. The Cavaliers, after losing to Opelika in a one-point game last week, they've traveled to Cedartown. Bulldogs up 14-0 second quarter. And a reminder that our live look-ins tonight brought to you by Breda Pest Management, the official pest control of high school football. So, two-screen experience all season long. Tonight, it is here in Westlake. It is also in Cedartown with Globetrotter Greg. Back to Matt and Wayne at 260-14.
To the air they go inside the 10-yard line and down to the 5 with a beautiful strike from R.J. Johnson to Jabari Jones.
Once again, R.J. Johnson, good read, knows where he wants to go with this ball, getting it out of his hand quick, good protection up front, and threatening for another touchdown. First and goal here are the Lions.
6 for 6, 124 yards for Johnson. 7 first downs for Westlake. First and goal to go again for the Lions. Thomas going to race to the pylon, the stiff arm and the touchdown. Third touchdown of the night already for Jaden Thomas.
And this play is all Jaden Thomas. As we talked about, 5'9", 175, little man with a big game. Two defenders standing in the backfield when he gets this ball and just showing you the quickness. And why we say he runs so tough, look at the technique right there, switching hands, putting it in the outside hand to get into the end zone.
PAT is good by Kamara, and it is 26-0 Westlake. Just 15 minutes into this game.
Hand off, two men in his face. Getting out of the tackle right there to get to the edge. Good vision, great feet. What a night. Cool customer. Look how he's walking to the sideline like, yeah, that's what I do. I score touchdowns. Big time game so far.
Three of them already for him tonight. Scoring drive brought to you by the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. A two-play 33-yard drive that was set up by another 25-plus yard punt return by Avion Terrell.
Headed to Clemson. Terrell showing you a lot of talent. We know he's a deep threat receiver, but right now his biggest effect on this game outside of shutdown corner is the yardage and the field position he's given him on the punt returns.
So Westlake totally dominating this game right now. Crisp County is yet to even get a first down. In fact, Crisp County has negative yardage right now.
And they're going to have to find a way to deal with this pressure. This Lion defense is continually creeping up to the line, standing on the line, and they're bringing pressure. And the only way to defeat it is maybe some traps up front through the offense.
And Walker finds a seam out across the 35 and the 40. And the first big play for Crisp County with the ball in their hands, a 34-yard return. Here's the Westlake resume. It's brought to you by DBHDD. 2021, they were quarterfinalists last year. They were semifinalists in 2020. 2016. 2016, they were in 7A. 2020, 2021, they were in 6A. Now they're back in 7A. Won seven straight region titles, 2014 to 20. 41-3, their region record over the years since 2014, and they've been to the playoffs nine straight years. DBHDD, win by learning about safe usage of prescription opioids. So it looks like they're going to split out A.J. Brown here and bring Markevian Hartage in at quarterback. Hartage is the sophomore.
Still see this Lion defense showing a little pressure. You imagine first play in for Hartage. He might see a lot of pressure on this drive.
Heave the ball to the far sideline and incomplete. Threw it over the head of Ladarius Smith.
Trying to get away from that pressure, get out on the edge. Just not able to come up with the pass there. Just into the game. Only a sophomore learning his way onto the field. We expected him to get in the game, play 10, 12 snaps to give A.J. Brown a little rest.
I was wondering when they would pull the trigger on this. The problem is the issue isn't with A.J. Brown. It's A.J. Brown has no time. So it's a blocking issue. It's a protection issue right now. It's not the quarterback.
Better usage, maybe be out on the edge, find different ways to get him the ball away from the middle of this defense.
Hartage stands in the pocket, going to go deep and incomplete. Was looking for Brown on the near sideline. It's going to be third down.
A.J. Brown at quarterback. They brought a lot of pressure. Last two plays, they've dropped back, played a little zone, switching it up on the youngster who's been standing on the sideline, seeing all that man-to-man, and figured, hey, I'm going to go down the field right there. Great zone coverage on the back end by the secondary of Westlake.
Yeah, they had A.J. Brown bracketed. So now it's third down and 10. Still looking for their first down of the game.
And this is what this defense has done all night. Forced Chris County offense into third and longs and has dominated it and kept it from getting first downs.
Chris,
timeout. Chris County, their second charge timeout of the half.
Crisp is 0 for 4 on third down conversions because third and 10 has actually been a good yardage for them. They've been third and much longer than 10 most of the night. A timeout is called there by Lawrence Smith.
And hats off to this defense, being able to, as their coach talked about, especially in the secondary, he comes from Kennesaw State. He brought that defense, especially in the secondary once again, to play, and he says they're quick to learn it. They're playing it at a high level. And as we have seen, he likes effort and he likes hitting, and that's what he has so far in this game by his defense.
Westlake has put 11 players in the National Football League. That's the seventh most in Georgia history, led by Cam Newton, a free agent right now, A.J. Terrell with the Atlanta Falcons, then Pac-Man Jones, Kieran Fox, Sean Jones, Keith Adams, the former Clemson star, all played at least seven seasons or more in the National Football League. You played with Pac-Man. I didn't play with him, but played in the league when Pac-Man was in the league, right?
A big war eagle to Cam Newton, I have to say that, but yes.
False start on the offense. 5-yard penalty. We play third down.
Well, when you're Cam Newton, you're going to make the top of the list for the NFL alumni when we're talking about high schools, right?
And Pac-Man Jones, as you alluded to, when he's with the Titans, when he first got into the league, and he was one of those dynamic players, as we talk about with Avian Terrell, that shuts you down at corner and punish you in the special teams with his return game.
Third and 15 now. And another timeout called by Crisp.
Timeout. Crisp County, the third and final timeout of the half.
So all kinds of issues for the Cougars right now. We'll step aside as they figure things out on the sideline.
While we've got a quick break in the action, did you know that the same area of just one football field can contain up to 95 termite colonies? That's why you need Breda Pest Management to defend your home. Breda, the official pest control of high school football.
When you work on your own terms, every day feels like Friday. That's why at Friday Health Plans, we provide health insurance for professionals who do just that. Independents, freedom seekers, those who follow their own career path, even if it doesn't come with a company health plan. Open enrollment for 2023 health insurance starts November 1st. Friday Health Plans, for people who buy their own health insurance.
Sweetheart, please don't forget to wear your seatbelt.
I got it, Mom.
It's a really nice day, living in the right space. Breathing your eyes, got me feeling some kind of way.
Blink of an eye, so many tomorrows can disappear. Buckle up for your future. Every trip, every time. A message from the Governor's Office of Highway Safety.
Half of the nation's opioid overdoses happen right at home because people don't understand the dangers of taking an Oxy or Perc with a glass of alcohol for stress or to sleep. Learn how to protect your family from opioid overdose at opioidresponse.info.
7:54 left in the first half. Dominant performance by Crisp here, by Westlake here against Crisp. Second screen experience tonight is in Cedartown. Cedartown looking like they might put another score on the board again. Inside the red zone one more time against Callaway. So it's 21-0 in Cedartown, and it's another score on the board possibly in short order here. The way things have been going, it's been a long night for Crisp County. Once again, brought to us by our friends at Breda Pest Management, the official pest control of high school football. Dominant performances we've seen on both screens tonight, Matt.
Indeed we have. Crisp County still looking for that first down. They're 0-for-4 on their third downs and facing a third and 15 right here from the 36-yard line. Got to get to the other 49 for a first down. Heavy rush, ball is out, and going to be recovered by an offensive lineman. Or maybe not. Let's see who's got it.
Big time off the edge pressure once again with the big hit. John Betts knocking the ball out, coming unblocked. Line sliding to the left here. Samaj Chatfield sliding left. Nobody to put a hat on John Betts. Big time collision with the quarterback. Never saw him coming off the edge. Fortunate for Chris County to get that ball back and get this punt here going to save him some yardage.
So Mitchell on the punt again, gets it out of there. This will be returnable by Terrell from the 35. Another big return for Avion Terrell down the sideline and still tight ropes the sideline. That is a touchdown for Terrell. 65-yard punt return touchdown.
Ladies and gentlemen, showing you all the stars. Looks like he wants another star by the end of the season. Avion Terrell, we've seen him each and every time on punt returns. Look like he's about to break loose. He clutches his helmet when he does get tackled here. This is just about raw speed and athleticism. Out on the edge, I'm faster than you. I have great balance, and I want a touchdown. Touchdown, Avion Terrell.
Gonna take more than two-hand touch to get him out of bounds. 33-0 following the 65-yard punt return touchdown for Avion Terrell.
Nice middle of the field, caught the ball, great vision, and now it's just feet and speed, balance. As you said, Matt, two-hand pushing is not going to get him out of bounds, and we kind of already saw this coming. He seemed like he wanted the score in the punt return tonight, like he just had a fever that he was going to get in the end zone and finally got there.
I think he's probably got at least 150 yards in punt returns already tonight. He's had close to two 30-yard returns and now a 65-yard return.
And good blocking, too. I must say, that was some good blocking there by the return team to be able to spring him to get to the edge.
Morris Mitchell, who's the special teams coordinator for the Lions. That'll make your job a little bit easier when you got Avion Terrell returning the kicks, right? Ball's going to be picked up at the 10-yard line. Trey Walker is going to be stopped at the 27. That's where Crisp will go on offense.
Right now, as their coach talked about, Coach Rico Zachary, he said that one thing he counts on is his special teams to play special. And we've seen on the coverage team, this Crisp County return team is something special. And right now, they're being shut down by this coverage team of Westlake.
So Crisp goes back out there on offense, and unless they figure out a way to block all the pressure that Westlake's coming at them, they're not going to have much success moving the ball tonight.
This Lion defense is dialed in. They're changing up the coverages. They have a lot of movement, and the thing about them, they are hungry. When they come off that edge, they're coming fast, hard, and good tackling by them as well.
Nothing doing for A.J. Brown, who was lined up at the running back position that time. He takes a loss. Actually, that was Chatfield. Pardon me. That was six, Chatfield.
Sekou Peters, 54, just pushing the pocket. This defensive line is two or three steps in to the backfield. Really barely enough room to hand the ball off there for Hartage right there to Chatfield.
Minus five on the play, second and 15.
Going with the hard count, trying to get this aggressive defense to jump. Very disciplined play so far for Westlake.
Hartage, that is a completion up close to the 30-yard line, the 29. They're going to rule that incomplete. Apparently, Ladarius Smith could not hold on to it.
A good time to try to get this ball to Trey Walker somewhere out on the edge or down the field. They're his big play. He's the guy, the best player on this team with the ball in his hands. And so far in this half, we haven't really seen him have any effect on the offense.
Nope, not at all. Third and 15. Hartage stands in there, incomplete. Trying to go to Ladarius Smith again, and it's fourth down.
Tight coverage, a lot of pressure. We're talking about a shorter quarterback at about 5'10", 5'11". Not really able to, with that kind of pressure, to see over the defense. And once again, this Lions smothering defense so far. Hasn't even let this Crisp County offense sniff their side of the field.
So once again, David Mitchell on to punt again. I'm guessing he got instructions on the sideline. Whatever you do, don't kick it to number eight.
It might be time for a little soccer kick.
Rugby-style kick.
Rugby-style kick to get it out.
Mitchell ends up down on the ground. No flag. They do kick it away from Terrell. It's going to roll dead at the 28-yard line. 49-yard kick by David Mitchell. That'll go down as one of the highlights for the Cougars so far tonight.
And I think on that play, Avion Terrell was not back there to even try to return the ball. 5:35 left in this game, and this Crisp County defense helped their team out with a three and out or a turnover, any kind of life to give their offense a shorter field to maybe have some success.
So first and 10, maybe Crisp can come up with a turnover defensively, help themselves out on offense. Handoff goes to Jaden Thomas. Thomas gets around the edge, and Thomas gets shoved out of bounds around the 44. Ends up being tripped up by one of his teammates on the sideline.
And right now, Jaden Thomas is doing just what his coach wants, control the game. Good vision, bouncing it outside, a little stutter step there to get the defender to pull up. And then he turns on the jets on Trey Walker to get to the edge. Having a great game so far. One of those player of the game type games he's putting together. Three touchdowns and big time running.
That was a 14-yard pickup. Pass complete out here on the edge to Zion Williams. As we approach 5 minutes to play here in the second quarter, Williams with his first catch of the game. And R.J. Johnson is still perfect. He has yet to throw an incompletion. That was a 7-yard pickup right there.
Looks in total control, smooth, reading the defense from the jump.
7 for 7 for 131 yards. Now he's going to run and step out of bounds at the 50. And it's going to be fourth down. Let's see what they do here.
Good protection there by the offensive line on that short pass. Didn't feel comfortable delivering the ball. No pressure in his face. Just bouncing it out on the edge. Get a yard. Short. Set up a 3rd and 3.
Yeah, you know, I don't know how they figure out those stars, but Rivals has him as a 2-star, and I don't even understand that. Guy's thrown for over 7,000 yards in his career. And he 7 for 7 tonight. Every time I see him play, he just plays great. Somehow he gets stuck with a 2-star label. 3rd and 3, actually, and incomplete. The first incompletion of the night. Coverage by K.J. Morrell, the nickelback. Now it's going to be fourth down.
Bring in the pressure. It's Chris County off the edge. R.J. Johnson, like maybe he was rushed on that pass there. First incompletion, but he seems to starting to have a firm grasp of this offense, and that's what Coach Zachary has been looking for.
7 for 8 for R.J. Johnson here tonight. His team in total command. First punting situation for the Lions, and Christian Campbell is the punter standing at the 35-yard line. This will be the first possession they've had in this half that has not ended in a touchdown. Fair catch is called for and made at the 19-yard line. That is where Crisp will go back on offense following a 31-yard kick. And let's check in with Hannah Gooden in our studios.
Thanks, Matt. The halftime theme on the scoreboard is revenge, and I've got a score update for you. South Paulding looking to avenge 2 losses in a row to Carrollton. They're up right now by 2 points, 15 to 13. We're following that one and many, many more scores. That's all coming up at the half. We will also announce our TikTok challenge winner. Matt, Wayne, you're on TikTok, right?
That would be a negative.
Yeah, I can't say that I am, Hannah.
Come on, guys.
1st and 10 for Chris. They go back on offense. Let's see. Yep, they keep Hardage in the game. I think really that's probably their best option is to have Hardage at quarterback and try to figure out a way to get the ball to Brown in some space. They haven't been able to do that yet. Direct snap goes to the running back, Chatfield. He gets dropped for a loss.
Nice job there by 52. John Betts, once again, coming off the edge, just won't be blocked. Out on the edge, running it down.
And Betts is having a huge game. That's his 3rd tackle behind the line of scrimmage. 2 of them have been quarterback sacks.
Playing a more zone with Hartage at quarterback. Going to make him, force him to find the open man. Hey, you
got him, 2nd and 15 and complete. And that's Trey Walker up to the 25-yard line.
Nice read there by Hartridge. Find Walker, and we just talked about, you got to find a way to get the best player on offense the ball. As Coach raved about, no one on the team is better with the ball in his hand. You got to find different ways, regardless of the play, of getting him the ball, testing whoever is guarding him on defense.
Yeah, said Brown's the best athlete. Walker's the best guy with the ball in his hands. So they got to start working towards that. Third and five. Heavy rush, Hartage, and the ball got batted down at the line of scrimmage. It's fourth down.
These late dog and blitzes by this defense, inching up each and every time, closer to the line, and you can just see how many times tonight guys have come unblocked.
51 for Chris County, let's lead the field for one play due to his helmet coming off.
Nice shot there by Harper Holloway of getting off the block, getting his hands up, and knocking that ball down.
So Amir Dwight has to come off the field because he lost his helmet on that play. So now it's fourth down and five.
This has been a great weapon for Westlake. His punt return today has set up short fields. If we saw Terrell go for a touchdown.
Kick is going to hit at the 40-yard line and bounce sideways. And that's where Westlake will go back on offense at about the 41-yard line. 34-yard kick by Mitchell. Let's take a look at the Westlake Lions next level. These are players currently playing college football. Jaden Hunter, redshirt senior linebacker at Western Kentucky. Miles Sims, redshirt junior DB at Georgia Tech. Nate Wiggins and Dakari Collins, sophomore corners and wide receivers at Clemson. And a couple of Georgia Tech Yellow Jackets, Leo Blackburn and Horace Lockett.
ACC looks like it has a pipeline to Westlake, huh?
They're doing all right. You know, we saw Blackburn a couple of years ago here on GPB, and I thought he was the most talented of their wide receivers, even though he was a three-star and they had all these other four-stars. Looking for him to bounce back after having a knee injury last year. And the first quarterback sack of the game for Crisp. Finally get to R.J. Johnson, five-yard loss.
R.J. Johnson looking for the big play down the field, buying time, trying to wait for that to develop. Good pressure there by Chris County to bring him down.
I think that might have been Omarion Young, the junior defensive end, with the quarterback sack. So second down and 15.
Three timeouts for the offense. We've already seen Ahmad Butler make some big plays. So Chris County, you're still not off the hook. Got to play this set of downs out.
Young coming with pressure again. They chase Johnson out of the pocket. He runs to the near sideline and steps out of bounds at the 45. So that'll bring up third down. So back-to-back plays where they were able to get some pressure on R.J. Johnson.
Early reads by Johnson. He's had a lot of success. We've seen when he struggled has been when he can't make that throw on that early read. Nice decision of him of pulling that down, trying to cut that down in distance in half.
By the way, can we get a vote for Swedish uniforms in high school football? I mean, those things are smoking hot with the lake across the front. Like that. Third down and seven. Heavy rush again. R.J. Johnson, quarterback sack, back at the 34-yard line. Ian Cleckley with the sack.
Finally bringing pressure. This is Cougar defense. They've seen it on the other side of the ball. It's their time. Not really sure where to go to the ball, but that early pressure there seemed to scare him out of it. Right here, linebacker dogging in, center having to try to take two on the play, not able to deliver the ball. Julian Fox with the pressure up the middle, running into Cleckley on the edge.
So fourth and 16, and for the second consecutive possession, the Lions have to punt.
Imagine in this situation, Westlake take the penalty, call a timeout. burn as much clock as they can.
High snap goes over the punter's head. Great opportunity for Crisp. It's covered back at the five. The long snapper on that play, at least on the depth chart, is Jabari Jones, the wide receiver. He snapped it right over the head of Christian Campbell. Crisp County has a chance to score here with 33 seconds left in the half.
One-handed snap, very high. You didn't give the punter any chance of being able to bring this ball down. It's 3 or 4 yards over his head. Just a bad snap there. And giving Crisp County a little life to build some momentum going into the halftime.
I believe that was actually recovered by Calvarius Armstrong, number 23, after Campbell fell on top of it. It came out from underneath him. So first and goal to go for Crisp here at the 5-yard line. New life for the Cougars to do something positive before heading to the locker room.
Sticking with Hardage, a quarterback, you imagine in this situation, maybe go back to Brown with his ability to make plays with his feet. But he's down at the bottom of your screen, not on the edge.
So first and goal to go. Snap goes to Hardage, going for the fade route, and Walker catches it over his shoulder for... Is it a touchdown? It is a touchdown. Great catch by Trey Walker for the 6, and Crisp County gets on the board.
We talked about Trey Walker trying to find a way for him to start having an effect in this game. Good matchup out on the edge, playing wide, just a man-to-man. Good throw, give the receiver a chance to bring it down, and Walker coming with the touchdown.
And the PAT up and good, and Crisp finally on the board here in the final minute of the second quarter. Wow, watch this catch by Trey Walker.
And that's what they call being out on an island if you're Ramon Mosby. No other players in the screen. Nice job leading him to the pylon. Nice catch, a late call for the touchdown by the ref.
None of the refs ever threw up their hands. There is a universal signal for touchdown that is recognized by everybody. They just looked at each other and shook their heads yes.
Nice job by Walker. Give his team a little momentum, some life here in this first half that's been dominated by this Westlake Lion defense.
So after the bad snap on the punt, Crisp County cashes in on the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign scoring drive. Just 5 plays. Just one play, 5 yards, but a big 5 yards for it to come right before halftime. That gives them a little bit of positive momentum there.
And we felt like with Hartage at quarterback, that might be something they have to stick with to be able to get the ball down the field against these corners and keep Brown out on the edge, where in this kind of game, he's probably more effective in trying to catch him in a matchup and throwing the ball down the field. On the touchdown, it was Trey Walker's.
So here's the kickoff by Mitchell. Gonna sail into the end zone. Had a little adrenaline in that kick. Nails it deep, and Westlake will bring it out to the 20, and it's 33-7.
And really, the snap on the punt, this is the only bad play Westlake had. It just led to 7 points for Crisp County, but offense and defensively, really the only negative play that they had in that half.
That shows you just how crazy the game can be. They played a near perfect half. They had some penalties, but you make one mistake and it cost you a touchdown. So let's see if they just take a knee here. They do have all 3 timeouts remaining. Handoff goes to Thomas. Thomas is coming to the near side, and he's running down the sidelines. I'm getting ready to say, you got to get some hands on that guy and push him out, because they will tightrope that sideline and go right by you. We've seen that tonight.
Once again, bouncing this out on the edge. Good blocking up front by Gaston and Barrington. Nice job by the receiver, not holding, let go at the end. and set up this offense for at least one chance, maybe down the field for a big play.
Let's see if they take a shot here. The clock is winding down. Nope, going to hand off to Thomas again. And that is going to be the end of the first half. Dominating does not even begin to describe that first half for Westlake. They lead it 33-7 as the teams head to the locker room.
Just giving no room for Chris County offense to move the ball anywhere in that first half. Big time early pressure, really forcing them to go to Heritage to try to get the ball out on the edge. Finally having a little success there at the end after the bad snap to get the touchdown to Walker. And you imagine in the second half, they're going to have to make those same kind of big chunk plays to have a chance against the Lions defense.
But the Lions defense just suffocating, too quick for Crisp County to block. They brought a lot of pressure from a lot of different angles. John Betts, defensive end, had a big half with three tackles for loss. Let's check in with John Nelson.
Thank you very much, Matt. Let's take a peek at what Coach Zachary has in mind. I guess we can break this down, two questions to two separate sections. Let's talk about the first 22 minutes of the first half and what you thought.
I mean, I thought we played hard. You know, we always tell our players, you know, when people watch the film on us, we want to make sure people say how hard we play. They compliment us on how hard we play. And we did that. We made some mistakes, but, you know, at the end of the day, effort makes up for mistakes. So we're going to continue to do that.
I was going to say, then let's look at the last 2 minutes where Crisp started getting pressure on the quarterback, got the sacks. You had the issue on special teams, which led to their one score. What did you think of the final 2 minutes?
We shouldn't have never been in that situation. We got to run the football right there. We run the football, run the clock out, get out the half, you know. But that's on me as a coach. We got to do better than that. So
we'll keep an eye on the second half. Thanks for hanging out.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Rico Zachary, the head coach for Westlake. That is his appraisal of the first 24 minutes. Hannah, what else is going on right now at 2:60 as the halftime show starts about right now?
Right now, in just a few minutes, coming up on the halftime show, we'll hear from Westlake cornerback Avion Terrell, update you on the top games happening around the state, take a look at our play of the first half, and name our TikTok challenge winner. You don't want to miss it. We'll be right back.
Buckle Up Georgia and the Georgia Public Safety Training Center have teamed up to bring you a crash course on why buckling up is so important. We're back in Forsyth, Georgia, where Gypsticks crew is preparing for our upcoming virtual reality rollover crash.
So just as the manufacturers and engineers that put these cars together, when we're trying to tear one up, we have to think about what we want to do, what we're trying to accomplish, and then some of it's trial by error. We put things in that doesn't work, we make modifications, and that's why some of the labor and some of the time is involved in this thing.
Steering, turn on, brake.
To prepare the car, we've installed certain devices to help us drive the car remotely. So we've installed a steering apparatus that gives us about 20 degrees of steering as we drive down the road. And the tricky part with this one, because we want to put real dynamic steering in to get a rollover, we've installed a secondary steering mechanism. Of course, for safety, we've got a braking mechanism in case it doesn't go as planned. We can stop, back up, and regroup. And we've got an accelerator controller to control the speed of the vehicle going into the crash.
And with all the modifications made, it was time for a test drive.
To make sure everything is working together and working the way we want it to, we do a couple of test runs where we sped up to about 20 miles an hour and we induced the steering, and we were able to get a considerable amount of roll angle on the car. So I think that we're going to achieve our goal and be able to roll this one pretty successfully.
So tune in next week for the Buckle Up Georgia Rollover Crash.
Hi, I'm Tommy Sharp with You Save It Pharmacy, and I'm proud to present to you this week's You Save It Pharmacy Student Athlete of the Week.
You see kids that are listed as athletes, he's just that good at playing multiple positions.
I like him all, coach.
And I challenged him to be a more vocal leader. He really surprised me.
Me and my teammate, if they do want help, they know they can come to me.
A I hope you've enjoyed watching the USAVIT's Pharmacy Student Athlete of the Week. If you'd like to watch our full interview, please follow this link.
Half of the nation's opioid overdoses happen right at home because people don't understand the dangers of taking an Oxy or Perc with a glass of alcohol for stress or to sleep. Learn how to protect your family from opioid overdose at opioidresponse.info.
Cigna is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna's mission is to improve the health, well-being, and peace of mind of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being.
Welcome to the Football Fridays in Georgia Halftime Show presented by Regions. Get back in the game with Regions Bank. I'm Hannah Gooden. We're live from the GBB Sports Studios in Atlanta. It's halftime of Crisp County versus Westlake at the Lions Den. These two teams have only played once before in 2001, where the Cougars took the W. Then they are not so lucky tonight. Westlake up 33-7. Tonight, one of the storylines for Westlake is senior cornerback Avion Terrell. The four-star prospect committed to Clemson in June. And no one was happier than his brother, former Tiger standout and current Atlanta Falcon A.J. Terrell. We've been talking about him tonight. A.J. was a first-round draft pick in 2020 and is teaching his younger brother some invaluable lessons on and off the field.
He stay in Atlanta, so every day we talk to each other. He'd be at the house every day, so I see him every day. Even when I play a game, he tell me what I'm doing wrong. He get on me all that. He always tell me to stay humble, be humble, work, always be the one to do extra work, be the first to everything, first to class, all that.
And he is a humble kid, so Avion will be a legacy player at Clemson, but he did say that Auburn was so close. To see the full interview, check out this week's episode of Recruiting 2022 at gbb.org/sports, or it will re-air right after the postgame show. Stay with us. Coming up next, we'll take a look around the rest of the state and check in with John at the Lions Den. Been through a lot over the past few years, remote learning, missing activities, traumatic events, and it's affecting their mental health. These issues are more common than most people realize, so it's important that parents and teachers know the signs. Today, we're joined by Liz Gallis from Cigna, who will give us more insight on what to watch out for and how to help your teen. Liz, why is it so important to recognize and promote teen mental health?
Well, Hannah, the reason that it's so important is with the pandemic, we have really noticed an increase in teen mental health, an increase in stress. 60% of Atlanta teens have had an increase in stress as a result of the pandemic. Many teens are not comfortable or even know that something is going on to even bring that up. So it's really important that we intervene sooner.
What are learning signs in teens that may indicate struggles with mental health?
It's important that we really pay attention to changes and what is different from what you know to be typical in your teen. So are they sleeping differently? Are there changes in their appetite, changes in how they're engaging with social media? Those are things to pay attention to.
In what ways can we support our teens' mental health during this time?
It is so important to be open and have those conversations, ask those tough questions. Also, to be able to model good behavior in yourself, to show them that you're talking about the difficult times. And be open, if you need to seek out help from your child's pediatrician or to seek out a qualified therapist.
Liz, thank you so much for being here. Thank you for this amazing information. For more, please visit Cigna.com.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by Georgia's EMCs. So much more than electricity.
Today's conservation-minded consumer cares about where their energy comes from. Your local EMC cares too. Georgia's electric membership cooperatives offer renewable options for our members. In fact, our solar portfolio will produce enough clean energy to power more than 180,000 households. Striving to move the needle toward progress and position communities for the future. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is about all Georgians standing together for substance abuse prevention. Celebrate life. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
Welcome back. It's halftime of Crisp County versus Westlake at the Lions Den. Right now, Lions up 33-7. It's only week one, but some Georgia teams are already looking to avenge tough losses from a year ago. Let's take a look on Georgia EMC scoreboard. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity. Let's start by going from Savannah to Miami for a border war where defending 4A state champion Benedictine is looking for revenge over Columbus, but the Cadets are trailing 14-7 right now. South Paulding is looking to avenge two losses in a row to Carrollton. It's been a close one all game, but Carrollton just went up 21-15. Walton knocked Brookwood out of the 7A playoffs last year and looking good again. Raiders up 27-14 over the Broncos. In Middle Georgia, Northside and Peach have a record of 2-2 over the past 4 years. Who will win the tiebreaker tonight? Eagles up by a score in the second, 14-7. And last year, Washington County rallied back from a big fourth quarter deficit against Swainsboro to win it. The Tigers are trying to not let that happen again. They're up 21-0 at the half. For more scores and to take our game with you on the go, download the GPB Sports app by scanning the QR code on your screen throughout the night. Time now to check in with John Nelson. And John, we're not only broadcasting from the Lions Den, we're also streaming Callaway versus Cedartown. What's happening in that one?
It is all Cedartown tonight for Globetrotter Greg. Greg Jackson is the one who is large and in charge of that particular game as a part of your multi-screen experience. 28-0, it is all Cedartown. Callaway, remember, lost last week in a tough one, in one of those border war games that we like to talk about. 1 point loss to Opelika. Cedartown ranked in the top 10 from the beginning of the year in the GPB polls, really putting the pedal down early and often tonight in our stream game. Once again, that's brought to us by our friends at Breda Pest Management all season long. Great to have this second screen experience, the multi-screen experience, Hannah, tonight in Cedartown. And a little birdie told me next week it's going to be a big one that we'll have for our multi-screen experience in Middle Georgia.
Ooh, can we spill the beans?
No, that's all. I'm going to say. Just keep, that's the location.
I don't even know.
That's the location. The location, so that's what we'll say for now.
Gotcha. All right, John, well, you always have your eye on all kind of games. What else is happening around the state tonight?
Well, you've got Clinch in Macon County. Clinch is leading that one 10-6. And another one of the border war games, sometimes out of necessity, you've got a schedule out of state. Marist had to go to Pike Road, Alabama, defending champ in one of their classifications. Pike Road, a growing suburb in Montgomery. And we'll get into full disclosure in just a second. Apparently, Marist bought 400 tickets. And that comes from the Pike Road superintendent. Marist really traveling, and they have been dominant so far. It includes a 65-yard interception return for touchdown, 20-7, second quarter. Marist on the road, leading Pike Road, defending champ in one of the classifications in the state of Alabama. Rome is putting up a big number. They're leading Lithonia 42-0 third quarter. You've also got Colquitt leading Stockbridge by the score of 29-0. We caught up with Sean Calhoun on the Football Fridays in Georgia podcast this week. Go to your favorite podcatcher and listen to our conversation with Coach Calhoun. He talked about his expectations coming into that one. That's just a few of the games going on. Osborne, by the way, could start off the season 2-0. They're leading Chattahoochee 20-7, second quarter up in Cobb County. So Osborne turning some heads early on. The alma mater of an actress you might remember, Julia Roberts.
Oh, wow.
Osborne, right now. Yeah, Osborne 2-0 if they win tonight against Mike Malone and Chattahoochee, but they've got a lead second quarter. That's just a small sampling of what's been going on around the state. Obviously, we'll keep an eye on what's going on third and fourth quarter here from the lake and get you ready and get you leaned into the postgame show where we're hoping to catch up with coaches Benedictine and Christopher Columbus down in suburban Miami. Last we saw, that one was 7-7. Luke Cromenhoek had a touchdown pass early on as that one is looking to go back and forth. So you've got that kind of, you wanted revenge? Here's revenge. Christopher Columbus won in Savannah last year. Benedictine trying to do the same thing down in South Florida tonight.
Absolutely, John. We have our eye on that one. Well, back there at the Lions Den, we always love cross-classification games, but Chris County being 3A and Westlake being 7A, does that have anything to do with the score tonight, John?
I think that more than anything, it was just this, it's the size of the front sevens. And I'll ask a coach coming up here in just a little bit, you know, about those kinds of things. It's just when you've got a dominant front seven that Westlake has, that we've seen from Rico Zachary, it's hard to have the quarterback have enough time, really. And it's just, that's why you saw work to the outside. And that got some yardage. And then you had the special teams mistake, which led to the score.
Thanks, John. Go take a halftime break. We'll step aside as well. Coming up, everybody, we'll show you our play of the first half and announce our new TikTok challenge winner. It's all coming up.
Flint Energies and 31 other participating Georgia Electric membership cooperatives congratulate Taylor County High School on winning the GHSA Cooperative Spirit Sportsmanship Award. This award honors schools that exhibit exemplary sportsmanship during competitive events.
Taylor County is a great place. There's a lot of really, really good people here. Definitely we want to win when we're on the athletic field, but we also want to make sure that we're, you know, continually doing, you know, good things and showing good sportsmanship. So we work hard and we preach that really hard to our coaches and then our coaches down to our athletes. You know, being an athlete at Taylor County High School means being a good person in the community and doing good for everybody in the community as well.
Introduced in 2006, this award reinforces the GHSA's philosophy that everyone associated with high school activities, from athletes to spectators, should adhere to the fundamental values it represents.
Flint Energies invest in schools because we know they're helping to shape the future leaders of our communities. We're thrilled that the Georgia High School Association recognizes what we already know, that Taylor County schools exhibit amazing sportsmanship throughout the year.
Time for the presentation here at Taylor County High School. Great hospitality with everybody here in Butler. So once again, we come here, Jenny and Flint Energies for the presentation.
Georgia's EMCs and the 32 participating membership cooperatives are proud to sponsor the Cooperative Spirit Sportsmanship Award. Congratulations to the Taylor County community.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by Cigna. Together all the way. Cigna is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna's mission is to improve the health, well-being, and peace of mind of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being.
Sweetheart, please don't forget to wear your seatbelt.
I got it, Mom.
It's a really nice day, living in the right space. Breathing your breath, got me feeling some kind of way.
Blink of an eye, so many tomorrows can disappear. Buckle up for your future. Every trip, every time. A message from the Governor's Office of Highway Safety.
Welcome back to Football Fridays in Georgia Halftime Show presented by Regions. If you're just now joining us, here's our GPB play of the first half. Westlake up 33-7 over Crisp County. Second quarter we go. Avion Terrell on the punt return. He finds room to the right. He'll get a huge block and tiptoes his way into the end zone. 65 yards for the touchdown. Westlake goes up 33-0 after that one. I'm sure his brother AJ is watching tonight. And you know Clemson fans love to see that. Time now to announce our winner of the new GPB Sports TikTok Challenge. The challenge is simple. Each week, our featured teams will be given a sound of our choice to compete with. You can choose a dance, share a practice, game week prep, team activities, or highlights. So many people voted this week. And although Westlake did a great job, our winner is Crisp County. Let's take a look.
Thank you.
Thanks for voting, everyone. Go follow us at GPB Sports on TikTok for more information on the challenge and to submit your video for next week's Football Friday and Georgia Game of the Week, Brookwood versus Collins Hill. Also, stick around after the game for the GPB Sports postgame show. We'll have coaches on standby all around the state ready to talk to us about their matchups. That's it for the halftime show. More from Westlake versus Crisp County. It's Matt, it's Wayne, it's John, right after this.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by Georgia's EMCs. So much more than electricity.
As morning light signals the start of business, Georgia's electric membership cooperatives are right there with you. Georgia's EMCs are a partner in economic development, serving commercial accounts big and small that drive Georgia's economy. From leading industries we rely on to local shops we treasure, we support operations on the ground, care around the clock, and growth through the seasons, lighting up good business so business is good. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is about all Georgians standing together for substance abuse prevention. Celebrate life. Live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
At Regions Bank, we're here to listen to your needs, and we'll customize a plan to help you reach your financial goals. Our service to Georgia goes beyond banking to creating more inclusive prosperity in our communities. From education to financial wellness to economic development, we're working to level the playing field so more people can succeed and our communities can thrive.
To go before the second 24 minutes here with Coach Smith to get the Crisp County perspective on the first half. Their size, meaning Westlake's up front, was causing a lot of problems for you early on.
That's something that we knew, you know, coming into the game. You know, like I said before, you know, the big team, physical, and they play fast. You know, we're just going to try to stick in there, continue to play with great effort, and, you know, use our quickness to try to make some plays to get back in this ball game.
And I know that you had the quarterback change to try to get your athletes out in space as a part of that, but you also, late second quarter, were able to get pressure on the quarterback, which created the special teams error, which got you those points on the board in a different way.
Yeah, and those are the things that, you know, we try to hang our hat on again. A great effort is something that we try to do, you know, to help make plays in this game, and we're going to have to continue that to try to get back in this ball game.
We'll keep an eye. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Lawrence Smith, the head coach of Crisp County. So that's the point of view from the folks that have a tall mountain to climb here in the second 24 minutes, Matt. Matt and Wayne, let's get us ready for the second half.
You hit the nail on the head. They got a lot of work to do down 33-7, Matt Stewart and Wayne Gandy. And Wayne, exactly how do they come back from a 33-7 deficit?
It's one of those old adages of one play at a time. When you look at this team, their defense is going to have to make some plays for them, give them the short field. This offense of Crisp County is just not going to be able to drive the ball against Westlake.
Wayne, let's take a look at the first half stats, a story of dominance for Westlake. And one of the things that the stats do not tell you is all the yardage they got in special teams from Avion Terrell,
which was a big weapon for them in that first half, the yardage he provided and the big touchdown. But when you look at these stats, it's just a dominant performance by the Lions defense. Negative yards, rushing, just playing on their side of the ball. Pretty clean game. Only one first down for Crisp County. They just can't find anywhere to go with the ball. 0 for 7 on third down.
Did get the one first down when they scored a touchdown. And so got that right there in the final minute of the half after a special teams mistake, ironically, by Westlake. So 33-7 as we get ready to start this third quarter. And I'm wondering, is it Hartage back at quarterback, or do they go back to A.J. Brown at quarterback here in the third quarter?
I imagine they're going to have to stick with Hartage to give him a chance of getting Brown and Walker, as we saw with the touchdown, out on the edge. He's a better pocket passer, and we saw a little wrinkle. When Brown's at quarterback, they consistently are man-to-man, bring pressure. Hartage, they drop back, play up more zone, and he's allowed to kind of survey the field, see if he can get the ball out quick to Brown and Walker.
Well, ready to get started here in the second half. 26-point lead for Westlake. Scored 12 points in the first quarter, 21 points in the second quarter, and running back Jaden Thomas scored three of their touchdowns in that first half of play. Third quarter kickoff is brought to you by Buckle Up Georgia. Buckle Up Georgia, seatbelts save lives. So Westlake will be getting the ball to start the second half. R.J. Johnson, 7 of 8 passing for 131, a couple of touchdowns. Ahmad Butler, 3 catches, 81 yards. Thomas, 11 carries, 46 yards. And Mitchell puts this one in the back of the end zone. So Westlake will start at their 20-yard line.
You imagine Westlake is going to come out, go Zachary, establish the run with Jaden Thomas. As we saw, he got stronger and stronger each carry. Try to cut this game in half, eat some time. And R.J. Johnson, 1.7 for 7, having an excellent half, especially early on, reading the defense, getting the ball out of his hand.
Defensive leaders for Crisp County, Ian Cleckley, their defensive end, had 3 tackles, a quarterback sack, and a TFL. Julian Fox also had 3 tackles and a TFL in that first half. So Westlake back on offense from their own 20-yard line. Coming to the near side, and Thomas is dragged down from behind by Julian Fox, 4th tackle of the game for him.
Fox stepping up at that Mike backer, coming through clean, but once again, Jaden Thomas with the vision and the quicks to get to the outside. Watch how he just outruns him to make a positive play for Westlake. Unblocked is Fox, just not able to bring him down.
Second down and 7. Impressed by the physicality of this Westlake team in every phase of the game as well. Slant across the middle up to about the 27-yard line. That was Jabari Jones with the catch. Brings nice, up third down and short.
Nice communication there between Jones and Johnson. Pre-snap. Saw the safety playing a little soft. Just get the ball out of your hands. Get the positive yards.
You see Jabari, he's already got 6 offers. He's just a junior. Purdue, Maryland, and Boston College among those 6. Third down and 2. Thomas, and he's going to pick up the first down as his body falls across the 30.
Nice job again of bouncing to the outside. A lot of bodies in the middle. He's coming across the defense, using his vision, getting to the outside to pick up that first down.
So first and 10, ball at the 31.
What a big game he's had so far, and just consistent of giving you effort, and we continue to see him grow as this game goes on. His coach talked about his playmaking ability, and this is the kind of 4 or 5 yards, just positive yards they're looking for from him.
He really kept them in the game offensively last week in their 21-17 loss to North Cobb.
Timeout. Westlake, the first charge timeout half.
So Westlake uses their first timeout of the third quarter. We'll step aside.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by DBHDD. Win by learning about safe usage of prescription opioids.
Half of the nation's opioid overdoses happen right at home, because people don't understand the dangers of taking an Oxy or Perc with a glass of alcohol for stress or to sleep. Learn how to protect your family from opioid overdose at opioidresponse.info.
Hi, I'm Tommy Sharp with You Save It Pharmacy, and I'm proud to present to you this week's You Save It Pharmacy Student Athlete of the Week.
I don't think he realized how good he really is.
I do everything that I can to be myself.
I mean, I think he is the type of person where he cares a lot about his teammates.
Well, I do a lot in the classroom to make sure that I'm keeping my grades maintained.
And the type of person that he is, I mean, he checked all the boxes.
latest Cam Davis, class of 2024, Doherty High School.
Hope you've enjoyed watching You Save It's Pharmacy Student Athlete of the Week. If you'd like to watch our full interview, please follow this link.
Two minutes into the third quarter, Westlake on top 33-7. They burn a timeout early here in the first couple of minutes of the period as they now have it first and 10 from the 30-yard line.
Interesting time for a timeout. Just got a first down. You're doing what you want to do. Just kind of put a drive together and eat up some clock, put even more pressure on Chris County.
Blitz is coming up the middle. Johnson gets it out of there to the sideline. About a 7-yard pickup on the play. Ball goes to Banks.
Nice job just getting the ball away from the traffic in the middle of the field. Get it to the talent out on the outside, as we talked about. Excellent game when he makes quick decisions with the ball and get it out of his hand.
So second down and 3. Thomas driving those legs and picks up the first down. You love the power in that little guy. 5'9", 175, but runs much heavier than that. He hit those defenders and drove them back.
Nice job reading here, keeping an eye on the DN. He's playing soft, so you hand the ball off. Just shoving and pushing to get that first down there is Jaden Thomas.
He's got a guy pulling him from behind, a guy trying to stop him from the front. He's still moving the pile. 12 carries, 55 yards for Jaden Thomas tonight. From the 41, Johnson to the far side, and catches made. Short gain over there. First catch of the night for Travis Smith.
Quick reads, get the ball out of his hand. It's R.J. Johnson doing an excellent job taking what the defense gives. Haven't seen a lot of deep balls by this offense. They are very comfortable just taking the 5-6 or whatever comes with the throw. We saw some big plays earlier to Ahmad Butler, but it was more of the 7-8 yard throw, and then he runs the ball another 10-12 yards.
Second down and 6. Thomas stopped right there at the line of scrimmage, sets up third down. That was Amir Dwight, who's committed to Southern Illinois, making that tackle. He's a guy that Coach Smith says if he was about 3 inches taller, that Southern Illinois commitment would be a Power 5 commitment.
Disruptive is what his coach called him. Some days in practice, they almost have to slow down to get some of the plays off. They're going to need him to do that here in this game and get this, especially it's a big third down. Once again, can't continue to let Westlake just walk the ball down the field and take up time.
Third down and 4 to the sideline it goes, and that's a first down. Jabari Jones got slippery over there and picked up the first down.
Nice job of him of gathering himself and getting up the field. No panic. Having to go down and bring the ball in. Just slipping there, you can see on the turf, feet almost coming from under him, but still able to power himself to the first down.
You can see why, even though he's just the second game of his 10th grade year, he's already got Power 5 offers.
I got to get him, tell us what's up with the hoodie in mid late August here.
Looks good. It just looks good. First and 10. Thomas runs into the arms of Cleckley. Nice gain again. And what I really liked about that play, if we get a chance to see it again, is how naturally he changed the ball to the other arm as he made the cut to the outside.
Great technique. Big time block up front by one. Gasson, 73. Finishing the block here, giving him a chance. and his vision and his leg strength. You can see the drive. He's taking three or four defenders to bring down a man who's listed at 175.
Second down and four to the air, complete to Jones again, and Jones is going to be stopped short of the first down. Caden Daniels, the safety, making the stop.
Quick decision, get the ball out to the edge to Jones once again. The physicality and finishing the play by Westlake on both sides of the ball has been excellent tonight. Once again, setting up a second and short and keep this drive alive and making it hard on Chris County. They're just letting Westlake, you got to start maybe taking some gambles.
Third down and one and incomplete. First time they haven't really been able to connect. I think just the second incompletion for R.J. Johnson right there, threw it behind Jabari Jones, and it's fourth and one.
And I think you dial up that play because you had already decided, if you coach Zachary, that you were going to go for it on fourth and one. So you took the chance. It was there, just a bad throw, as you can see. R.J. Johnson patting his chest, just a ball too low, had the receiver Jones wide open.
Fourth and one. Toledo's got to be really happy about the commitment from R.J. Johnson. He gets the first down. Incredible poise, like I said. And you said it in the open. It 4 years. We've been seeing this guy play for 4 years for Westlake, yet they still label him a two-star. And I've never seen anything but poise and accuracy from him.
Going with the trick play right there, Matt, I call that. You know, in today's football, the quarterback under center is a trick play right there to pick up the quarterback sneak. Nice job of him finding that soft spot, line driving their legs, pick up and continue having this clock to tick down on Chris County.
See, R.J. chose Toledo over Georgia Southern. Also, East Carolina offered him. Jaden Thomas running hard, picks up about seven on that play.
Great burst once again by Thomas. On these runs, the defense seems to be surprised at his speed. Once he gets out on the edge, looks like he's caught dead to rights. And then you see him right here with the burst, just outrunning the defender. Nice stiff arm to get KJ Morrell, who's a top player for this Cougars defense, off of him. Nice job by Thomas.
Yeah, you mentioned Morrell. He is a junior nickel. Six offers, Kentucky, Liberty, and Troy. Second down and four. Prospects for Westlake have been better than the prospects for Chris County. Johnson being chased and going to be dragged down at the 35-yard line. Nice open field tackle by Julian Fox again. That's a loss of four on the play. The second TFL for Fox in this game.
Early reads, R.J. Johnson having a lot of success throwing the ball when he seems like he can't get the ball out of his hand. Looked like he was trying to get a little pump and go action out on the edge. It didn't come. And the pressure by Fox, once again, bringing him down. Third and eight. And if Chris County defense, you got to get off the field right here.
15th play of the drive right here. You said it. They're walking it down the field and eating up time. See Fox, 11 offers, including App State, Army, and Western Kentucky.
Taking their time, letting the clock. This has been the only drive in this half so far. They're milking it for all it's worth.
Running a screen to Thomas, not going to pick up the first down. That was Fox, I think it was Fox, who made that tackle to keep him from getting the first down.
And you have to decide if you coach Smith here, this might be four down territory. The way your defense plays, you get another set of downs. That is Fox right there getting in on the play along with Caden Daniels.
Yep.
Bring him down, but fourth and four. The defense and the way they're playing and the field position. This is a great gamble by Smith here to keep this drive going.
Line to gain is the 17, setting up a screen, and Thomas going to get swallowed up, fumbled the ball, and the ball's going to go over to Crisp County. I think they might have ruled that an incompletion. Either way, Crisp gets the ball. So Westlake drives it 16 plays until the drive stalls. Crisp comes up with the stop.
Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. Celebrate life, live drug-free. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is about all Georgians standing together for substance abuse prevention. Celebrate life, live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
All right, what do you think, Jasper?
Honestly, I think that polyester shirt's affecting your game.
What?
I think cotton would have been a better choice.
Cotton?
Yeah, it's come a long way, you know. Nowadays, cotton breathes and makes moisture great. Plus, buying cotton means supporting Georgia farmers. I think that's wonderful.
Okay, sure, but what do you think about the putt?
Oh, guess really hadn't thought about it.
Today's conservation-minded consumer cares about where their energy comes from. Your local EMC cares, too. Georgia's electric membership cooperatives offer renewable options for our members. In fact, our solar portfolio will produce enough clean energy to power more than 180,000 households, striving to move the needle toward progress and position communities for the future. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
.254 left here in the third. Dominant performance, 33-7 still. Westlake leading Crisp. Remember, GPB is a multi-screen experience this year. Our second screen tonight is in Cedartown. Just as dominant a performance. Two more points on the board for the Bulldogs than we've seen from Crisp. 35-0, a bit of a stunner there. Cedartown leading Callaway. That one is late third quarter, heading for a running clock in the fourth in Cedartown. Right now, let's send it back to Matt and Wayne for the remainder of quarter number three.
Thank you, John. That was 16 plays, 9 minutes off the clock. Westlake. That's exactly what Rico Zachary was looking for right there. He wanted to get points, but if we don't get points, we just shorten the game.
Great job of taking that ball, eating up the clock, putting a lot of pressure on an offense that you've been dominating. And once again, pressure in the backfield. Sekou Peters again, this defensive front playing on the other side of the ball for Westlake.
Yeah, I mean, they're going to end up with negative yards rushing here tonight, barring some kind of change in the tempo and flow of this game.
Little bobble on the quarterback, running back handoff. And soon as the Samaj Chatfield got the ball, he saw big number 54 standing in his face.
AJ Brown back in there, quarterback. Gonna go for the home run. First time they've tried to go vertical and cannot connect with Trey Walker.
Something we expected they were going to have to start doing to have a chance, get the ball to Walker out on the edge. A.J. Brown back at quarterback, just not keeping the ball in the field to give Trey Walker a chance on that throw.
Brown, a commitment to Ole Miss, over 26 other offers, including Clemson, but he's committed as a safety.
Dynamic safety, good size at 6'1". 195. You imagine once he gets to Ole Miss, they put that extra 15, 20 on him. And playing quarterback, that definitely will help him at that position.
No doubt.
Able to read,
yep,
and see where the quarterback's going already, something he's done.
Will do nothing but help him down the road in recognizing offenses and what's happening. Throwing on the run, and it was caught or not. I think it's incomplete. Incomplete is the call from the field.
Pressure in his face, having to roll out, throw the ball on the run, just coming a little short on the throw here. See, consistent pressure he's seen all night long. This time Harper Holloway trying to throw it, And you see the ball right there at the end just squirt out of the hands of the receiver.
Calvarius Armstrong, who's been in on some special teams plays tonight. And it's 4th and 14, and Crisp has to give it right back.
And if there's been a phase that has dominated equally to the defense, it's been the punt return team for Westlake, especially when Evian Terrell has had the ball.
Ball coming down and hitting at the 25, and Terrell thought about scooping it up and then decided not to. Chris thinks that Terrell touched it when he reached up when it was hopping over his head. The officials won't agree with that.
I never saw the flight path of the ball change, but like it's still in discussion.
Gonna take a look at it right there. Looks like he touches it, doesn't it? Look how the flight of the ball kind of changes here. It looks like he tips it, doesn't it to you?
Definitely does. Only thing, he didn't react like he, maybe he didn't feel it in his hand at that point, because imagine the kind of player he is.
Because he let it die.
He let it die down.
Yeah, he didn't feel like he touched it. Otherwise, he certainly would have covered it. So Westlake's going to take over at the 7-yard line.
Yeah, plenty of time if he touched it right there to go get the ball.
No, and he stood over. So 1st and 10 from the 7. Thomas gets driven back by Jamarian Troutman, the linebacker.
This County defense, we've seen a couple of times they had success, has been because they played on the other side of the ball. Troutman, the Mike linebacker right there, meeting Thomas in the hole for to create 2nd and 10. And you would imagine any chance in this game, this defense has to start 3 and outing this offense. Last drive taking almost 10 minutes off the clock.
By the way, that was a 56-yard punt by David Mitchell that pinned him deep. 2nd and 10, Thomas, one man missed him in the backfield. Thomas breaks out of there and finally got tied up around the ankles at the 23-yard line.
Getting out of the arms of K.J. Morrell coming off the edge to nickel. Jaden Thomas, we've seen this consistently tonight. Being able to get out of tackles, get to the edge, and this is that part where we say he's only 175, but he definitely runs with the strength of a runner that's about 220.
Having a 16-yard pickup, 19 carries, 84 yards now for Thomas. Gets wrapped up at the line of scrimmage. I think Julian Fox was in on that tackle again. You saw big Amir Dwight lose his helmet. Yeah, he's hurt too. He was the one who had his helmet got knocked off. Amir Dwight, probably their best guy on the defensive line, 6'1", 260 senior, as we mentioned. Committed to Southern Illinois, over 9+ offers, including Samford and Florida A&M. See big Lawrence Smith. He started Washington High School in Atlanta, played for Rodney Cofield, then went on to Tennessee State. From there, the NFL. So watch for 51. Watch the helmet, wherever that comes off. There it is. The helmet's off already, and he's in the middle of that tackle.
And it looked like maybe it was just a cramp. When he went to stand up, his leg cramped on him.
Yeah,
a lot of these players going both ways, trying to get production. It's like he's okay. It's up in the jogging.
Yeah, Dwight also plays on the offensive line as a backup. This is probably the final play of the third quarter.
Like Westlake is going to let the clock run out, hoping to start that fourth quarter, going another long drive like they did to start the second half.
Well, that was not the last play of the third quarter. The previous one won. 33-7 Westlake leading Crisp County as we head to the fourth quarter in Atlanta. R.J. Johnson, only two incompletions tonight. And A.J. Brown trying to get loose for Crisp County.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by DBHDD. Win by learning about safe usage of prescription opioids.
Half of the nation's opioid overdoses happen right at home because people don't understand the dangers of taking an Oxy or Perc with a glass of alcohol for stress or to sleep. Learn how to protect your family from opioid overdose at opioidresponse.info.
Cigna is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna's mission is to improve the health, well-being, and peace of mind of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being.
Every game day celebration, every championship title begins here with hours of unseen work. As part of our commitment to education, Georgia's EMCs support the young athletes who play high school sports in the communities we serve. Empowering talent with scholarships, honoring sportsmanship, saluting the game changers. When we champion the energy behind the scenes, they can step into their future and shine. Georgia's EMCs, official energy provider of the GHSA.
Welcome back to the Lions Den, getting you ready for the fourth quarter. 33-7 is the score here at Westlake. A lot of games going on really around the Southeast involving teams here with Georgia high school ties. There's a QR code that you can go ahead and aim the phone right at. You can get all the scores that you want that are attached to GPB all season long. Get your favorite teams, your favorite scores. The QR code is available for you right there. Give you a couple of scores as examples around the state. Our second screen experience, 41-0 right now. It is all Cedartown over Callaway. That one, it has under 10 minutes to go in Cedartown. Globetrotter Greg has been the one shooting that one. You can go to gpb.org for that one. We've got a couple of finals as well. And Marist beating Pike Road 33-14 over just south of Montgomery with about 7 minutes to go regulation. Back to Matt and Wayne at 260-14.
All right. Thank you, John. The fourth quarter actually starts with a tackle by Jamarian Troutman. And we are underway in the final period. How about Callaway? I mean, that's a top 10 team in 3A getting nailed tonight by Cedartown. Didn't see that one coming.
Matt, if I'm not mistaken, Christian Wilson, number 21, just ran the ball for Westlake, which would be the first time that someone ran the ball, not named Jaden Thomas.
That's right. So Christian Wilson getting some run here, the senior running back. Thomas right around 90 yards rushing through three quarters. Third and 10, R.J. Johnson going up top, and it is broken up. Trey Walker broke it up at the 49-yard line.
Reading man out on the edge by Trey Walker on Travis Smith, trying to pick up the big play going downfield. As I say, early read, get the ball out of his hand is when he's had success, keeping the ball up high, and just a nice play by the Middle Tennessee commit, Trey Walker.
Yeah, I thought he almost came down with the interception right there. He was high pointing the ball. Good job to deny Banks out there on the edge. Actually, that's Travis Smith, number 10, out there on the edge. And it's fourth down, and Crisp is going to get the ball back. Christian Campbell on the punt. Going to hit at the 49 and cross the 50. And roll dead 10 yards later at the 41. So Crisp going back on offense. So the question will be, if Hartage at quarterback, or will it be Brown at quarterback?
The going to give yourself a chance. If you feel like you're going to come back in this game, most likely you put Hardage in there to try to get the ball out to A.J. Brown. But if you coach Smith, you might just want to get some offense going. You're down 26 points. Just want to put who you think will be the team going into next week out on the field and start building some confidence and driving the ball.
And next week, they'll host Lovejoy. That'll be next Friday night down at the Cougar Den in Cordele. So first and 10, negative 44 yards rushing for Crisp tonight. Brown stays in there at quarterback and overthrows Trey Walker. Second down.
This is a good time. Right now, you don't have anything to lose. You want to just execute your offense. A.J. Brown, the one aspect in his game, we know he's athletic. We know he's going to play hard. But he's going to consistently see teams challenge him to throw the ball. And it's hard on this young man, trying to play both ways, especially when you're moving over from safety, you're winded, your mind is thinking about so many things.
Ball fumbled and recovered. Never dropped to the ground as Brown was able to retain it, but he was juggling the ball, and it's going to be third down. And I think that might be what you would consider one of the differences in 3A and 7A. In 3A, you can probably go a long way and win a lot of games with an athlete at quarterback who doesn't have to throw the ball. 7A is much more demanding.
Especially when offensively you're asking the quarterback to be the guy making the plays as well. There's one thing, a lot of times a quarterback can do this in any situation, 7A, 3A, if there's other people like a run game to support him. But as you can see, tonight it's just been this D-line, these linebackers, the pressure, just nowhere for him to go.
Another quarterback sack for the Lions.
In his face, pressure once again there by Sekou Peters, Peters, Betts, Holloman, Ahmad Johnson. You pick a number on this defense. They're having a meeting at the quarterback.
So fourth down, another punting opportunity for David Mitchell. Line drive kick. Avion Terrell has it bounce right to him at the 16. Actually, that's going to be Jabari Jones on the return that time. And Troutman loses his helmet. So I'm guessing we've probably seen the last of Avion Terrell tonight. But what a first half he had returning the ball. Troutman's hurt on the play. So while they tend to him, we'll step aside. Westlake on top, 33-7.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. Celebrate life, live drug-free. DBHDD and the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign is about all Georgians standing together for substance abuse prevention. Celebrate life, live drug-free. Learn more about healthy alternatives and living a drug-free lifestyle at garedribbon.org.
Hey guys, it's time to reveal what I'm doing after graduation. We got my cupcakes and we got my schools. Let's just do it. Cupcakes aren't really my thing, and neither is going to a four-year college. Instead, I'm getting paid $18 an hour to train as a commercial plumber. There's a ton of other trades, like electrical and carpentry, where you can make great money, live a great lifestyle with little to no debt, and even be your own boss.
Sweetheart, please don't forget to wear your seatbelt.
I got it, Mom.
It's a really nice day, living in the right space. Breathing your eyes, got me feeling some kind of way.
Blink of an eye, so many tomorrows can disappear. Buckle up for your future. Every trip, every time. A message from the Governor's Office of Highway Safety.
Hey, Just under 9 minutes left in this one. Westlake in command, 33-7 lead on Crisp County. Matt Stewart along with Wayne Gandy in studio. Hannah Gooden and John Nelson coming up after the show with the postgame show. With all the scores, highlights, interviews with the coaches from around the state. That's coming up immediately following the conclusion of this one. Westlake going back on offense.
It's good to see Julian Fox get up on his own power and walk off the field. And if you're Westlake right now, you're just trying to execute your offense. As you can see, finally getting different backs in there, taking the load. Jaden Thomas looks like maybe he's done from the night.
That was number 22, Naeem Odenlee, sophomore running back on that last carry. R.J. Johnson still in there at quarterback. He's 14 of 17 tonight for 164 and a couple of touchdowns. And dropped pass at the 41-yard line and some punishment afterwards. Jabari Jones couldn't hold on to that one.
Nice ball, the catch there by Jones, just coming up with the drop there. He's trying to pick up a couple of yards to keep the drive going as Westlake.
They've got some talented wide receivers, but they're young. Travis Smith, Jabari Jones. Coach Rico Zachary told us they got to grow them up.
And that's why Jaden Thomas is so important right now for them in the rush game. We saw a big stride, especially in that first half by this offense throwing the ball. And R.J. Johnson, when he makes quick decisions, just like on that receiver, Jones didn't come up with the catch, but when he makes early reads, get the ball out of his hand, he looks excellent in the pass game.
Third down and 9. Approaching 8 minutes left in this one. Incomplete. Trying to make a pass completion there at the 47-yard line. That was Trey Walker on the coverage again, and it's fourth down again.
Two interceptions last week. Typically, if you can have a big game like that, next week the quarterback stays away from you. But Trey Walker has been tested a couple of times tonight. What a great athlete he is. Middle Tennessee recruited as a cornerback.
Westlake has not scored since the 65-yard punt return touchdown by Avion Terrell with just under 7 minutes to play in the second quarter. They jumped out to a 33-0 lead in the first 17 minutes of this game. Short kick, but it takes another bounce for Westlake, about 10, 11 yards on the bounce. And that's where Crisp is going to start back on offense at the 28. That's a 35-yard kick, and let's check back in with Nelly.
All right, we're going to have some final scores. We have some games that are late in the fourth quarter as we're getting ready for the postgame show. Cartersville gets a win tonight, 38-16. We've had games way down south that have been impacted by weather, like Early County and Seminole. That one's only in the first quarter. Ace, as a matter of fact, to give you an idea, scored 73 last week. They were held to 29 this week, but GMC in single A, they're now 0-2, losing 29-15. By the way, Colquitt, we mentioned weather. They're up 29-0 over Stockbridge. They are now officially in a weather delay. Mother Nature, Matt, is, as always, undefeated. More as we go.
Yeah, GMC Prep, that was a team that finished in the top 10 a year ago. They were top 10 preseason, but a couple of big losses here to begin the year. First and 10 for Crisp from the 29. Looks like Hardage is now back in there at quarterback, isn't it? Nope, it's still Brown, pardon me. And Brown going to be dropped. Another loss on the play.
Looks like he's holding his.
Yeah, that's the last thing you want here is for A.J. Brown to get hurt in a blowout loss.
Chatfield right there, the starting running back. Tomorrow's Chatfield, little hobbled on the play. Watch how this defensive line just brings the pressure.
Face mask on the defense. 15-yard penalty, resulting in a First down.
So a 15-yard penalty on Westlake as Chatfield goes to the sideline. Or is the penalty on Westlake? I assume it was on Westlake on the tacklers instead of the blockers. Yes, it's going to be against Westlake.
Rod House, number 48, right there working through that double team, trying to get A.J. Brown down. And you can see Brown on the ground being his own referee, grabbing his face mask, letting him know, hey, I got pulled down.
So first down for Crisp at the 41. That's just the second first down for Crisp in this game. K.J. Morrell on the carry. First time we've seen him run the ball tonight.
Starting linebacker, one of those guys that quickly can play both ways, fast, physical. Six offers there, Kentucky, Troy, Liberty.
Pretty good offers for a junior, huh? Morrell again runs right into the line this time. Dominating defense by Westlake tonight. Their defense played very well last week in a loss to number 3 North Cobb, 21-17.
For Chris Conley must lead the field for one play due to his helmet coming off.
That's the two or three times Amir's had to leave the field losing his helmet.
Very impressed with the defensive front of Westlake. We knew what they had on the back end in the secondary. But these D linemen and Peters, as we talked about, Holloman, Smith, Betts getting in the action. They have been disruptive. They're taking the gaps. They're using the athleticism. And they really have dominated the offensive line of Chris County.
Third down and 4. It's been a long time since I saw a defensive performance this dominating, especially against a team that was ranked top 10 in 3A. Brown going to run, pointing to his blocker to get that guy who comes up and trips him up. He's going to be a little bit short of the first down. So fourth down coming up.
You know the kind of athlete he is, not finding what he wants. Pressure off the edge there by Rod House. Trying to direct traffic to create the first down.
Avion Terrell making that
Terrell
back.
Coming up. Playing to the whistle. This is that hard play that Coach Zachary talks about. Is Avion Terrell.
It's third down and 2. Pardon me, I think I said it was fourth. It's third down and 2. Morrell trying to get around the edge and not going to be able to do that. Look at that pursuit again. Christian Peterson, their nickelback. They call that the striker position, coming up to make the tackle.
Beautiful tackle there by Peterson out in space against the kind of athlete in K.J. Morrell, trying to get it. Little stutter step, not falling forward is Peterson.
Peterson's a Rivals 3-star linebacker. 13 offers, got some good ones. Michigan, Ole Miss, Pitt Panthers. Fourth and 5, punting situation. You can hear Westlake High School's proximity to
timeout.
Hartsfield International Airport. In the background, you can hear the planes landing. Timeout called by Crisp. It's 33-7. Lions on top.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is brought to you in part by Regions Bank. Get back in the game with Regions Bank.
At Regions Bank, we're here to listen to your needs, and we'll customize a plan to help you reach your financial goals. Our service to Georgia goes beyond banking to creating more inclusive prosperity in our communities. From education to financial wellness to economic development, we're working to level the playing field so more people can succeed and our communities can thrive.
Cigna is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna's mission is to improve the health, well-being, and peace of mind of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being.
As morning light signals the start of business, Georgia's electric membership cooperatives are right there with you. Georgia's EMCs are a partner in economic development, serving commercial accounts big and small that drive Georgia's economy. From leading industries we rely on to local shops we treasure, we support operations on the ground, care around the clock, and growth through the seasons, lighting up good business. So business is good. Georgia's EMCs, so much more than electricity.
Welcome back to the Lions Den. Your score is 33-7, and games are having finals all over the state. I've got some updates for you. Rome beat Lithonia at home 49-0. We've got head coach John Reed waiting to be on the postgame show, so Rome Wolves fans, hang out for that one. Savannah Christian beat Islands 28-0. They also just called the Colquitt game 29-0 over Stockbridge because of weather. That one is over, and they get the W. Hey, a big update on my revenge list. Walton versus Brookwood. Walton up 43-20. The Broncos not getting the revenge they quite want. And we've got some other coaches confirming for postgame. I'm hearing maybe Cedar Grove John Adams hanging out. So guys, if any fans from teams with big wins and losses tonight, if you're a high school football fan, hang out for the postgame show.
Thanks, Hannah. That Walton-Brookwood game, a rematch of the quarterfinals you saw in GPB last fall. Looks like going to get the same result. Looks like Walton's going to bounce back after a shootout loss to Mill Creek in the Corky Kell Classic at Mercedes-Benz Stadium on Saturday. Going to bounce back and put up their second 40-plus point game of the season to even their record at 1-1.
I was able to catch that game last week by Walton, and that's just one of those programs that they're going to keep fighting and scratching and not be down long.
So Westlake going back on offense, and this might be a GPB first for us. Negative 35 yards for Crisp County. Can they get out of the hole and finish in positive yardage before the night is done? They're going to need a big run.
They're going to need a big play.
They need a big play to get out of the red. Christian Wilson on the carry.
It's kind of surprising here with 5 minutes to go that you still have some of your starting O-line is out there. R.J. Johnson still in the game. Really the only starter that has exited is Jaden Thomas.
You know, it is surprising, but after we talked to Rico Zachary this week, it's not surprising, right? How many times did we hear, if your motor's not running, you're not playing?
Play hard is his mantra. Toughness and hitting is what the kind of player he's looking for.
They're going pads and practices. He says they rarely go shells. They're going pads. Got to develop that toughness.
Says he keeps his eye on the guidelines to make sure that he's right up on the edge of pushing his practice to that kind of level.
Gonna max it out to the rules. You can tell this is a different kind of Westlake teams in the past. I mean, they were quarterfinalists last year, semifinalists in 2020. Great program, playing in 6A, but a much more offensive-minded. This, you can tell Westlake is going to be built around defense and running the ball. Not that they didn't run the ball in the past, but under Bobby May, who's now at Kell, great coach, love him to death, they were more offensive-minded. They've gone out and hired a defensive-minded coach in Rico Zachary.
And when you have a great defense like Westlake, you're looking for great special teams so you can get the ball and be able to punt and get returns. And you're looking for a run game where you can eat up clock. We saw all that on display tonight, where they can ball control you, short passes, receivers that get the ball and get upfield to complement this defense.
Yeah, in fact, I'm guessing when Nelly talks to Coach Zachary after the game, one of the things he's going to really be proud about is that 9 minute 16 play drive. Didn't score, but it took 9 minutes.
That means that his halftime speech was heard. When you come out as an offense got the ball to start the second half, and it was like scoring a touchdown when you're already up 26 points and you can take the drive and take almost 10 minutes off the clock. That was like a 7-point swing.
Yeah, not that Crisp County was coming back in this game, but when they got the ball finally with 3 minutes left in the third quarter, touched it for the first time of the second half, I mean, half of the second half had virtually been wiped out before they ever touched the ball again. So it's third down and 5 now. Pressure coming, and Johnson gets it out of there, and it is caught at the 50. Will be a foot race, and Jabari Jones is going to get into the end zone for the touchdown. 90-yard touchdown pass from R.J. Johnson to Jabari Jones.
I haven't seen this Westlake team take really any shots down the field here, trying to close out the game, going deep to Jabari Jones, who we've seen take short passes and work for 4 or 5 hard yards. This time, early read, a little movement in the pocket, showing you to have the arm, double clutching on the catch. And then it's just a foot race to the end zone, trying to chase him down. Not able to run him down is A.J. Brown. You saw him kind of holding his leg there at the end, like it was cramping. You know what kind of work he's had to do tonight on both sides of the ball. But what a timely to go down deep. Beautiful throw to get it, give his receiver a chance. Foot race, a little stiff arm. Might have got away with a little pull to get into the end zone, Jabari Jones.
Third touchdown pass of the night for R.J. Johnson. Career touchdown passes number 60, 61, and 62. And the scoring drive brought to you by the Governor's Red Ribbon Campaign. 3 plays, 95 yards, 90 of them coming on that pass play to Jabari Jones.
Showing what his coach talked about, not being rattled, low snap, had a little pressure in his face, still decided to stick with the play and go down deep for the touchdown.
So that'll blow up the stats a little bit for R.J. Johnson. 15 for 20 and 254, and Jones 6 catches for 140. That right there, just a little reminder to all the opponents who will be watching this game film. Oh, yeah, we can hit you deep, too. We hadn't done it all night, but we can hit you deep, too.
We do have those kind of athletes with Jones. When Terrell flips over and play receiver, we haven't seen a lot of that tonight. We saw early on with the big tight end, Ahmad Butler, as well. So they have those weapons. They're just young, and they're trying to learn this offense.
From the 5-yard line and sliding down at the 20, trying to make a cut. Crisp County will go on offense there with just 3 minutes left in this game. That was Trey Walker on the return. Hopefully he's not hurt too badly there. Hasn't gotten up yet.
Like on the cut, his feet just came from under him. He's pointing to his head.
He might have gotten a hit in the head as he was sliding down, trying to avoid the tackle.
Good blocking initially, and then his feet
right
just
there.
Slipped on him, and he
got hit in the head right there.
Like he caught a knee to the head.
I thought, now watch this. No, it's the initial contact right there with the hand. The guy, he's sliding down. The Westlake player, Chaz Jones, is coming in to make the tackle, and he got an arm bar right in the head as the tackle was trying to be made.
One player they definitely cannot lose to have success, Trey Walker. Only touchdown put on the board that late in that first half. A little fade route.
Looks like he's going to be okay. So Crisp will have to regroup here. They got some big games coming up. They've got, of course, next Lovejoy, Northside, Warner Robins on the 23rd, second-ranked Carver Columbus on October 14th, then close out at Thomasville on October 28th. So difficult road ahead for Crisp County as they try to regroup from this loss. And Westlake, next game coming up, number one Cedar Grove.
That's just like Coach Rico Zachary to schedule it that way.
I mean, they got Cedar Grove next. They still have a game against 7A defending state champion Collins Hill. Going to host Carrollton in October.
With this kind of defense, the way they play, that D-line continues to get pressure. The way they can play at the corner position.
Fumbled. And let's see who gets on top of it. Scoop and score. Touchdown, Westlake. Bryson Oliver scoops it up and scores.
K.J. Morrell trying to take the handoff from A.J. Brown. I don't think he ever really got the ball on this play here. Well, actually, Hardage is in at quarterback and never really got the ball. It's K.J. Morrell.
17-yard scoop and score for Bryson Oliver. And the PAT is blocked. And it's 46-7.
And we're going to have an offside here.
Encroachment on the defense. Half the distance to the goal. Reach.
Typically, Matt, when the outside rush guy can get his whole body over the ball, he's probably jumped offside. You see, when you go in to block a PAT, you might get a hand on it, but when you get your whole number over the ball, I think it's a giveaway that you jumped offside.
So Westlake will get another shot at it right here. And this time the kick is going to be up and good. It's 47-7. So a couple of late touchdowns here in the fourth quarter for Westlake get to stretch that lead out. You know, and a lot of times we say the final score is not indicative of how close the game was. Well, now the final score is indicative of how far these two teams were separated tonight.
It's that kind of performance. It syncs up with Crisp County offense being in the negative with yards. But Coach Lawrence Smith talked about he takes these kind of games against this kind of competition to get his team ready for his 3A region.
Nelly, what you got?
Give you some final scores and updates around the state since we're under 3 minutes to go getting you ready for the postgame show. Down in South Georgia, Appling County, a big winner this week in another one of those border war games. They beat Aiken, South Carolina. Telfair County in single A, a winner. Bleckley County, one of the teams, Matt, that I know that you and I have been looking at in single A to really make some noise. A big win over ranked Wilcox County tonight, 46-14. Vidalia, a big win as well. So Jason Cameron goes to 2-0 with a 48-0 win over Beach. More scores as we go. Bainbridge and Coffee heading to the fourth in a tight one. More in just a bit.
Yeah, we'll be keeping an eye on Von Lasseter's team. They're playing in single A. Swainsboro went down, too. They're another team to keep your eye on. 11-3 a year ago. They bring pretty much everybody back from that team. Trey Walker on the return. So Crisp County going to get the chance to run a few more plays here with 2:44 left on the clock.
Surprised to see him back in that situation, as valuable as he is to this team. It's good to see him out there and know that he can go back in the game, but he is one of your best weapons to have success is Trey Walker. And Coach Smith is going with that play it to the end mentality. down 43, 244 left. Still has his main guys in there.
Trey Walker, one of the positives for the Cougars tonight. Hardage gonna hand off the ball. And again, nothing in the running game. I've never seen a running game get smothered like this, like Westlake has done.
And it's all about that defensive front, regardless who's in the game. They have consistently and play after play. They're playing in the backfield of Prince County. And this is one of those areas that Coach Smith is definitely going to have to shore up with this offensive line.
So second down and 13 as we approach the 2-minute mark. Hardage to the air, overthrows his man Walker out there, and it's going to be third down.
You can see the frustration in his body language there as Trey Walker leaving the field. Tough for those kind of guys like Walker and Brown, they're seniors, and they're going to have to be the leadership that gets this team to bounce back.
You see he goes walking all the way down to the other 20-yard line. He was not happy about the fact that that ball was so poorly overthrown. Partridge to the air, and it's going to be caught in traffic by Ladarius Smith. Going to bring up about fourth and three or four.
Nice find there by Partridge to deliver that ball to Smith in traffic. You can see that potential that his coach talked about. So he's young, has a bright future, only a sophomore.
So fourth and four from the 46-yard line. And dropped. That would have been a first down catch right there. Caden Daniels, the intended target, and it's going to go over to Westlake. Now with just 1:17 left on the clock.
Daniels able to get inside the corner, just not able to come up with the catch.
Now Crisp is going to finish, Wayne, 0-for-10 on third down conversions.
Tough night for this offense all around. And a lot of that is just this Westlake defense bringing pressure, creating third and long on most of those occasions on third down, and then just smothering the quarterback, not giving him any time to step up in the pocket, make plays from the pocket. Always seemed like they were under duress as the quarterbacks of Chris County.
You saw the numbers there, 350 to negative 28. And that's pretty unbelievable. Pretty unbelievable for a team that came in ranked number six in 3A, a state quarterfinals. We get the whole 3A, 7A thing, but Crisp County overmatched from the opening whistle here tonight.
And as we talked about, quickly they got to forget this game. Sometimes this is where coach doesn't even watch this film. He just starts fresh. Let your confidence grow. They do have talent. They have a big offensive line. And that's going to be the key to them bouncing back next week. How fast can they get this behind them?
Wish them well. We had a great conversation with Coach Smith and Coach Zachary this week leading up to the game. There'll be better days ahead for the Cougars, but tonight, it's an extreme disappointment on this trip to Atlanta. Hawkins on the run, and there is a flag down. We'll check the call.
Personal foul. Horse collar on the defense. 15 yards will be added to the end of the run, which results in a first down.
So that's a first down with 1 second left on the clock. see where they're going to mark it off, and we'll see what Westlake does if they run another play or just take a knee.
I see Victory personnel out there, so I guess they'll just snap it and quarterback will just take a knee.
I kind of get the idea that's going to be it. Westlake wins it 47-7, the first victory for head coach Rico Zachary as the Lions head coach. And a successful return for Rico Zachary from 3 years on the staff of coach Brian Bohannon at Kennesaw State. A resounding win tonight over the young men from Cordele, Georgia.
This is this Westlake Lion team. They play from their defense. They look for them to make plays, create short fields, get turnovers, and then they rely on the special teams as well, as we saw in the punt game, punt return team tonight with Avian Terrell. And then the offense on the other side with Jaden Thomas controlling the line with the young offensive line and R.J. Johnson seeming to get a grasp of his offense, quick reads, getting the ball out of his hand.
So 47-7 the final as Westlake improves to 1-1 on the season ahead of their matchup against Cedar Grove next week. Crisp County falls to 1-1 and once again will be playing a higher classification next week when they welcome the Lovejoy Wildcats to Cordele. But I think, you know, you hit the nail on the head with Westlake. Westlake's just as good as they've always been. They're just going about it a little bit different way now under head coach Rico Zachary, but they'll be a force to be reckoned with in Region 2, 7A this season.
Defensive philosophy, as you talked about, looking for players that want to play hard, want to hit, want to leave it all out on the field. And we saw, especially in that first half defensively, just a swarm of defenders, different guys, just dominating their position, dominating their man.
Stick around. Our Georgia Cotton Commission player of the game is standing on deck and will be talking to John Nelson in just a few moments, along with head coach Rico Zachary picking up his first win as the Lions head coach. And then right after that, it's the postgame show as Hannah Gooden's going to step in here. And along with John Nelson, they're going to be talking to all the coaches around the state. Let's send it to Nelly.
Three early touchdowns means that Jaden is our Georgia Cotton Commission player of the game. The Georgia Cotton Commission is the natural choice for Georgia. All right, let's talk about the game here. And I know that you're going to do this, so I'm going to beat you to the punch. Let's give credit to the offensive line for clearing those holes. What's it like running behind those guys, especially losing a tough one last week, coming back today? What was it like running behind those guys today?
Like every day at practice, we work hard for this. So I trust them, you know. Coach Wright, great coach. He puts the work in for them. So everything behind them, I trust them guys.
So if I had told you that that final score was going to be the final score, that you were going to win against a really tough AAA team by 40, what would you have told me?
I believe it.
Excellent use of the towel, by the way, Jaden.
Exactly.
So if I had told you that it was going to be this kind of a margin, you would be this dominant tonight, what would you have told me?
I would have told you all this hard work we put in from the summertime, it's nothing. So this is us right here.
What was practice like in this week after the tough loss? What was the week of practice like getting ready for this game?
You know, Coach Zach, we came back in Sunday, had a hard lift, looked over film, studied their plays, all that. The following week, we came hard.
New head coach, new system, trying to get adjusted to things and try to figure out what Coach Zachary is wanting you to do. Obviously, good way to work things here tonight at home. What's it been like getting adjusted to a new set of things, knowing that the expectations are still the same?
It's been kind of hard, but, you know, I've been pushing through, trying to get this new offense ready. Our offensive scheme is kind of similar to last year, so it was kind of easy for me at first, but then it started getting kind of harder as we got more concepts in.
Jaden Thomas, congratulations.
Thank you.
The Georgia Cotton Commission player of the game, Georgia Cotton Commission, the natural choice for Georgia. All right, let's tag out. Rico! Time to tag out. It's the beauty of live TV. Well done. You get to keep that stuff. You get to keep it. Yeah, you get to keep that. There's your tag out. It's a hot tag. All right. Congratulations on your first win back as a high school coach. What has it been like this week after that tough loss to come back out here tonight and dominate the way that you had?
You know, I thought the kids practiced really hard this week, you know, and I think that was because the level that we played at last week, and, you know, we made some mistakes and stuff. We thought we had a chance to win the game. And, you know, just playing in an environment like that only makes you better. You know, so that's why we play these games. We like to play these games. All these games are like playoff games, you know. And it just makes, it continues to make us better.
Minus 28 yards allowed. So they gave you 28 yards tonight.
Yes, sir.
Minus 28, obviously a lot to be proud of in that rebound from the loss last week, but you were stifling all night long.
Yeah, our defense is playing hard right now. You know, we make mistakes, and we, you know, we got some things we got to clean up, but at the end of the day, they play hard, and they play so hard that they make up for a lot of mistakes that they make. So I can't really say enough about how they're playing right now. They just need to continue doing that.
Are you just as proud of the drive in the third quarter that took up 9 minutes, even though you didn't get any points? Are you just as proud of having something like that that you can carry forward with you as you were with the effort defensively tonight?
You know, you want to work on finishing the game.
Right.
And the drive was, you know, sort of finishing the game, but you want to be able to put it in the end zone and finish right there. So that's something that we just got to continue to work on, finishing games.
Congratulations on getting a win. Welcome back to high school football in
yes,
the state
sir.
Of Georgia.
Thank you. I appreciate you guys.
Rico Zachary, the head coach of Westlake, big win tonight for them, 47-7. Congrats. Go celebrate with your
yes,
team.
Sir. Thank you.
So let's send it back to 260 14th Street, because when the game's over, it's not really over. We got a lot more ground to cover tonight, a lot of action here in a Georgia high school football.
And be sure to join us next Friday night, Football Fridays in Georgia. Coming to you from Suwanee, Georgia, as the defending 7A state champion Collins Hill Eagles play host to the Brookwood Broncos. That's next Friday night. Remember, it all starts with recruiting 2022 at 7 o'clock and then the game of the week at 7:30. Here tonight, a dominating performance, 47-7. Westlake beats Chris. Wayne? A tremendous performance by R.J. Johnson. Avion Terrell had a 65-yard kick return touchdown, the punt return, and 47-7 the final as Westlake wins in dominating fashion. And now for Wayne Gandy and the entire GPB sports team, I'm Matt Stewart. So long for now. The post-game show is next.
Georgia's a major supplier of cotton worldwide, so if you'd like to buy local to support Georgia, buying cotton's a great place to start. It's renewable and sustainable, naturally. Thanks. That's a polyester fiber made of oil, by the way. Where's your dressing room?
We continue our coverage of National Signing Day. We go now to Atlanta, Georgia for Kevin Connor's official declaration.
After giving it much thought, I've decided that next year I'll be going pro and building my skills as a Georgia plumber!
What impacted your decision?
It was an opportunity to earn money and learn on the job. I really love working with my hands, building things, and being part of a team.
Another highly touted prospect enters the trades.
Go plumber!
At GPB, our goal is to create a space where people can come together to share and celebrate great content. Engaging with viewers and listeners is an essential part of GPB's mission to educate, inform, and entertain. Virtual events are a handy way for us to keep in touch with our friends and neighbors, even when we're apart, But there's nothing like spending some in-person quality time in our community together. So we hope you'll join us. Visit gpb.org/community to learn more about upcoming events.
Long summer days are upon us, and we hope you're enjoying all your favorite programming right here on Georgia Public Broadcasting. It's your donation at gpb.org/give that ensures we'll have the funds on hand to continue paying for the programs you love. Don't let the lazy days of summer keep you from doing your part at gpb.org/give. Your donation is vital and so appreciated. Thank you.
I got it, Mom.
It's a really nice day, living in the right space. Breathing your breath got me feeling some kind of way.
Of an eye, so many tomorrows can disappear. Buckle up for your future. Every trip, every time. A message from the Governor's Office of Highway Safety.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to be safe on every trip. Buckle up, Georgia.
Sports post-game show presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety. I am Hannah Gooden, Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to buckle up, Georgia. We had a good one tonight on our Football Fridays in Georgia. Game of the week at the Lions Den. It was Westlake versus Crisp County. Westlake was too much for the Cougars, winning 47-7. And I want to bring in my partner in crime, John Nelson, who is there on the field to talk about this big win for Westlake. It was head coach Rico Zachary's first win as a Lion. Some big playmakers tonight, John. Quarterback R.J. Johnson, cornerback Avion Terrell, running back Jaden Thomas. Talk about their performance on the field and what you saw tonight.
Well, and that was why I wanted to ask Jaden Thomas specifically about the offensive line. When you've got the biggins up front and they can just maul and maul and maul, that really made it easy for Westlake to work offensively. And when you've got the individual talents, especially on special teams with Avion Terrell, with the punt return that happened right in front of me and Kenny Price, you know, you have something like that happen, then you get the momentum that carries you through. Big win tonight against the team in Crisp County.
Another big win was for Marist, and we have head coach Alan Chadwick waiting to be brought on. One of my favorites in the state. We don't pick favorites here, but I do love head coach Chadwick. Big win over Pike Road on the road, 33-22. Coach Chadwick, that's a big road trip.
Well, it was a huge win for us. Really proud of our kids, how hard they played tonight. They gave us everything they had. We've been had a lot of breaks and a lot of injuries, but they came down here prepared and gave us a great week of preparation this week at practice. Backup quarterback Ian White came in and executed very well for offense. We had a couple of big plays on defense, interception return for a touchdown, and a scoop and score for a touchdown, and that was ended up being the difference in the game. But I'm just really, really proud of the effort of our players and excited about the big win.
Coach, it's John. I heard that 400 tickets were sold to the Marist community to make this trip to suburban Montgomery, Alabama. That's a pack of lunch and a dinner trip, but it says a lot about what Marist football and the Marist community means to these Friday nights.
Well, our people travel well, and we had great support, you know, and boosters. Our parents showed up in force tonight and made a loud noise and supported us very well, and we're just excited to have them and excited to give them a good win to go back home with on a long road trip.
Coach, I got to ask you one more. You went from class 4A to 6A. What have you seen so far in these two games about the reclassification and your competition?
Well, it's a tough road for us, and it's going to be a big challenge. We're a very young football team. We don't have as much size as we normally have. So it's a big challenge, and now the injuries have started to pile up on us. So we just got to keep putting the nose to the grindstone and trying to get better and keep working hard. But that's what these kids are doing us right now, is they're giving us everything they have every single day at practice, and they're letting us coach them hard. And we're improving. We've improved a great deal this week, and we got to go out and do the same this next week.
Thanks, Coach Chadwick. It looks like you just walked off the field, so thank you so much for calling in.
We certainly did, and it was raining down here, and it's hot and humid, and there's no showers here, and we got to get on the bus and come home.
That's going to be a smelly ride. Drive safe, guys. John.
Thank you.
Wow. No shower, huh? Wow. Okay. That'll be a unique ride home. I think you had the right adjective there, Hannah. But I mean, dominant effort was 7-6 Pike Road early. Then you have Maris with an early score in the second. Then you've got the 65-yard pick for a score. Then you've got Maris scoring again. They were up 26-7 at one point, actually up 33-7 on a scoop and score from 22 yards out, 33-14. And then obviously with a road trip, I think that Pike Road tried to close the gap a little bit, because Marist obviously tired, and Coach mentioned the backups and all of that kind of a thing. Road trip getting to you in the third and fourth quarter, but Pike Road down a lot, couldn't make the comeback. They had the onside kick late at 33-22, but big win. And apparently the Veer offense, and this is a universal trait, the Veer was confusing Pike Road's defense all night long, because it is assignment football, and if you're not used to it, it is going to be a long night for you defensively. It is dive, keep, and pitch, and it confused Pike Road all night long.
John, we were talking about revenge games on Georgia's EMC scoreboard. Did any of those revenge games get avenged?
Wow. I mean, you have the Walton Brookwood. You've got South Paulding and Carter and Carrollton. That one was close. It didn't quite get to the avenge part. I know that you and Matt got to talk a little bit about Walton and Brookwood. And it was a big win tonight down in South Florida with Benedictine and Christopher Columbus. Benedictine lost last year in Savannah to Christopher Columbus. They were tied at 7 down in South Florida. But from there, it was all Christopher Columbus. Big win for them. So Christopher Columbus wins both legs last year and this year against Benedictine, now with Luke Kromenhoek at quarterback.
Speaking of Walton Brookwood, we have head coach Daniel Bruner waiting to chat with us. Great timing. That is good live TV. They defeat Brookwood 34-20. Hey, Coach Bruner, tell me about your game tonight. Can you hear us, Coach Bruner? Yeah, on the bus, you're defeated Brookwood 34-20. Tell me about your game. It was Brookwood was trying to avenge that playoff loss. You knocked him out last year, and you were too much again. Tell me about your game.
The boys just responded. We talked about it all week long, responding after a game last week. Felt like we had chances last week, and we just did some things that were undisciplined and uncharacteristic of what we're trying to accomplish this year. So the response was phenomenal. The boys bounced back, started a little bit slow, but got it going. Needed to game off the right way.
Coach, a lot of times you wonder what's going to come to full song first. Is it defense before offense, or is it offense before defense? Which side of the ball is coming together for you faster from these first two games?
I'd have to say it'd be the offense. Offense obviously played a stellar game last week, and defense struggled a little bit versus a very good Mill Creek team. But, we learned a lot about ourselves in week one. And, for us, it was all about getting back to doing things we do, being disciplined on the defensive side of the ball. We had a couple bad fits, a couple blown coverages last week, and we're able to clean a lot of that up this week. So, offense still was clicking, but defense stepped up this week and did a nice job playing complimentary football, and we're able to come out with the W.
Coach, it looks like you take a week off before facing Pope on the 9th. What do you plan on working on in that week?
Getting healthy. We have way too many guys dinged up right now, and you never want to be beat up early in the season or any time of the season. But, we come out first game, and we got some guys in positions that we didn't plan on them playing. Early in the game, we had to pull some guys out. And at the end of the day, we're just trying to live by that next man up mentality and build a bench. And fortunately, we're playing some guys that are getting some experience that will hopefully help us down the road. So our key next week is getting healthy, learning from our mistakes, and getting better before we roll into the Pope.
Coach, which bus are you on?
I'm on the first bus, the offensive bus.
They're awfully quiet after a big win.
No doubt. Well, we partied a little bit before we got out of there, but hopefully they're resting and relaxing back there on the way out.
All right. Well, here at the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, we hope you guys get home safe.
Thanks so much. Go Raiders.
All right, we have more coaches calling in, but we are going to step aside and take a quick break. Stick with us. More from the postgame show. It's John and I next.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to be safe on every trip. Buckle up, Georgia.
Sweetheart, please don't forget to wear your seatbelt.
I got it, Mom. It's a really nice day, living in the right space. Breathing your breath, got me feeling some kind of way.
In the blink of an eye, so many tomorrows can disappear. Buckle up for your future. Every trip, every time. A message from the Governor's Office of Highway Safety.
Half of the nation's opioid overdoses happen right at home, because people don't understand the dangers of taking an Oxy or Perc with a glass of alcohol for stress or to sleep. Learn how to protect your family from opioid overdose at opioidresponse.info.
Welcome back to the postgame show presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to buckle up and be safe if you are heading home tonight from wherever you were at football games around the state. I'm Hannah Gooden. We'll check back in with John in a little bit. We have Roswell head coach Chris Pruitt here hanging out with us. They got a big win, 35-14 over Centennial. Hey, Coach Pruitt, tell me about your game tonight.
Yeah, we had a good hard-fought game. Obviously good to beat your city rival. And make sure we continue. We have a cup with them called the Mayor's Cup. So we always like to keep trophies in our field house if we can. So being able to come away with a victory was good for our team.
We had you on our airwaves last week. So you go 2-0. How does it feel to start the season off like that?
Yeah, it feels good. I mean, it's where we thought we should be and where we were hoping to be. So I know we got a tough couple of games coming up. So just trying to make sure we keep our level heads and make sure we don't go too crazy over being 2-0.
Break down what's clicking offensively for me.
Yeah, I mean, I think we've had a good success running the ball, and I think we're still working on getting stuff to our playmakers and making sure we're reading the right things and making the right decisions. When we get into trouble, like I kind of talked with John last week, it's we're not consistent and we have kind of some mental errors. We go backwards fast, but if we're on point and we're focused and making the right decisions, we look pretty solid up front, and we handle ourselves pretty well, I think.
Last question for you, Coach. You got Marietta coming up next Friday. What are you going to do in the meantime to prepare?
Enjoy the win tonight, and then we'll be right back at it in the morning, trying to get back in the lab and figure out what we can do to take care of Marietta. Obviously, winning a state championship 3 years ago, and it's a good program, and I'm sure they got a lot of talent and a lot of speed, and I know their coaches coach really hard and coach really well, so we'll have to be ready and be prepared.
All right, Coach Pruitt, thank you so much, as always, for your time, and we will talk to you soon.
Thank you.
Let's take a look at our Georgia EMC scoreboard. Georgia EMC, so much more than electricity. This is a revenge board, and I want to start by going from Savannah to Miami for a border war. We're defending 4A state champion Benedictine was looking for revenge over Columbus. They're not quite getting it. Christopher Columbus out of Florida is winning 35-9 in the fourth. And South Paulding was looking to avenge two losses in a row to Carrollton. It's been a close one all game. Carrollton up 28-21 in the fourth. We just talked about this game. Walton defeated Brookwood 34-20. Brookwood did not get their revenge from being knocked out of the playoffs a year ago. In Middle Georgia, Northside and Peach have a record of 2-2 the past 4 years. Looks like Northside is going to be the tiebreaker in that one, 35-7 in the fourth. And last year, Washington County rallied back from a big fourth quarter deficit against Swainsboro to win it. The Tigers did not let that happen again. 42-0 is the final. We've got Coach Boone on the line. Coach Daniel Boone Williams from Langston. Huge, big win over McEachern tonight. Hey, Coach, tell me about your game.
Hey, how you doing? It was a hard-fought battle, man. Coach does a great job over here at McEachern. My guys, I challenged them all week, and they were able to stand up to the challenge.
you just mentioned you were challenging them all week. What was your focus?
Focus on execution. You know, my new coach, you know, Steve's going to have a good job. I mean, good disciplined team. So I just coached us to understand and execute what we're supposed to be, our blocking alignment and assignments, and the unbelievable effort aspect.
John, you want to jump in?
Yeah, I'll jump in. Coach, let me ask you this. With the expectations being as big as they are for you at Hughes this year, how do you have the guys focusing on the task at hand in front of them as opposed to looking at all of us folks sitting there and saying that the expectations are as high as they are? How do you tune out the noise?
Because my guys are bought into our motto. That's to go 1-0. No game is bigger than the next game. The next game is the only thing that matters. And they're buying in. They're understanding really this season what they mean. So they're doing a good job with that. Not looking forward, not looking down the road. We got to take one play at a time. That equals to one game at a time.
Coach, you have Mays coming up. Tell me about what is it going to take to get another W?
Oh, it's going to take our guys to come back and lock in on Monday and focus up and be ready to rock and roll. Mays going to come with they're a pretty good team, and they've been rolling right now recently. So, you know, we got to lock in and play our brand of football, you know, and they'll be there next Friday, and hopefully my guys are ready to respond.
Coach Williams, my favorite part of this show is having the coaches step off the field right after the game and give us a call. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you for doing that. I mean, you are fresh out of this one.
Yeah, right. I hadn't even been in the locker room yet.
Well, go celebrate with your team. Hey, what's your message going to be to them? Tell us.
My message is going to be to them. We took care of business. Now it's on to the next. We got maybe a 30-minute ride back, right? That's our only time we'll bask in this. We're going to ready to rock and roll.
Awesome. Well, drive safe, Coach. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you.
Hey, John, we got the post-game message first.
Well, what I was hoping is that, you know, maybe one of these times as we're getting a coach walking off the field is that he continues to have us on with him as he walks into the meeting to deliver the message with us live with him. Because we've gotten the bus, we've gotten everybody celebrating on buses. Now let's get them walking in the meeting to get that message. That to me would be all this stuff.
John, final scores rolling in. What else have you seen tonight?
A lot of crazy stuff out of Central Georgia. I'll give you one off the top of my head. Northside over Peach County by the score of 35-7. That one is also out there. And then Houston County and Perry. Let me try to find the actual score, because it was 57-56. And so I've got to find the Central Georgia element of it all. Hang on. I'm going to see if I can find it. But I'll find it. It was 57-56. I think Houston County ended up beating Perry in a 57-56 thriller, which is more reserved for November, December, January, or February. A lot of stuff going on in Middle Georgia right there.
Thanks, John. We are now going to catch up with head coach Franklin Stevens of McEachern. Hey, coach, you just fell to Hughes 47-21. Talk about your game tonight and what you want to see from your team going forward.
Well, yeah, I thought that you have to give Hughes a credit. They're a good football team, good athletic football team. They have players all over. I thought we played well at times. I thought we had issues in the secondary. You know, as I told my guys at the end of the game, not taking anything away from Hughes, but, you know, and they had something to contribute with it. But we had five busts in the secondary and that linebacker that gave big play touchdowns, and you can't do that against a good football team. So I'm disappointed in the way that, you know, we played at certain positions. But, you know, going into the season, we thought our line of scrimmages were probably going to be the strength of this team. We knew that there were going to be some issues in the secondary early on as far as guys getting baptized through fire. It's painful. You don't like it as a coach, but it's just one of those things where in the secondary, sometimes when you're young back there, you're inexperienced back there, those things are going to happen. So feel like that, you know, we can say that we're getting better, or, you know, you're close. But at the end of the day, when you're a good football team, you find a way to win those types of games. Like I said, you can't take anything away from Hughes. Those guys and Coach Boone, they did a great job coming in here on the road. I think they had some a little verse at the beginning in regards to getting the bus, getting here. So, you know, they were pressed for time and all those types of things. And then they came out and performed. They did what they needed to do to win the football game. Unfortunately, we didn't. But, you know, moving forward, you know, we're going to focus on just fundamentals. And to me, I think that's one of the keys at this juncture is, you know, we don't need to panic, focus on effort and fundamentals. And then once we get better with our fundamentals, and then our effort is where it needs to be, and all of a sudden some of that baptism has its effect, I think that we can be a good football team.
Coach, I was going to ask you, as we're right now in season one, which you hope gets you ready for season two, meaning region play, non-region getting you ready for region, which gets you ready for season three, which is the playoffs. What do you think some of the overarching messaging is going to be for your team coming off of this game tonight against Hughes for the rest of your non-region schedule?
Well, you know, like I said earlier, you know, you can sit there and go close but no cigar. I thought at times of the night that we had our opportunities. And we didn't take advantage of it, whether it was we need a drive offensively, you know, to get a touchdown, or whether it was a thing we needed a stop. I think it comes down to, you know, we've been in this situation before here at McEachern. Unfortunately, we don't play scrubs. I mean, I'm just going to call it what it is. I mean, when you look at it every Friday night, as I tell my guys, you got to go out and you got to get ready for a war. You got to get ready for a barroom fight, and that's just part of it. You know, when you're playing this caliber of football in 7-8, there's not a lot of the sisters and blinds and weeks on the schedule. So week after week, you got to get yourself lined up. I mean, last week was North Burnett. I think in their front seven, they might have had four or five, maybe five power five guys. Tonight in Hughes, I don't know how many they had them all over the place, whether it was offensively or defensively. So then next week, we're going to see Douglas County. They're going to have their few. Then we'll see Newton, and they've got one of the top guys in the country on the defensive line. And I think the following week, we see Tucker. They got a couple of them. And then we see we go down to Valdosta. So there's no rest for the week and weary. The thing about it is you got to come in on Monday when we start Monday, 6:30 in the morning, watching film. You've got to be open to the things that you've got to do to get better. You can't come in and, you know, fight coaching and believe that you have the answers. You got to have a mind frame whereas I'm mentally focused on what I need to get done and not just what I need to get done. I'm trying to make everybody else better around me. And, you know, that's what we've been able to do the last couple of years to get ourselves better. And like I said, you know, tonight, I get the blame for, you know, not having our guys prepared. You know, we've got to do a better job of getting guys to do exactly what we want them to do. So it gives us the best chance to be successful. That's what good football teams do.
Coach Stevens, you can get back to practice this week and prepare for Douglas County. We'll be keeping our eye on that one.
All right. Well, we appreciate it. Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much for your time, Coach. Mm-hmm. All right, everybody, we have more coming up on the post-game show. We have coaches calling in. As always, don't go anywhere. There's more next right here on GPB.
Cigna is a proud partner of Georgia Public Broadcasting and Football Fridays. Cigna's mission is to improve the health, well-being, and peace of mind of those we serve. Visit Cigna.com to learn how you can support your physical and emotional well-being.
Half of the nation's opioid overdoses happen right at home. Because people don't understand the dangers of taking an Oxy or Perc with a glass of alcohol for stress or to sleep. Learn how to protect your family from opioid overdose at opioidresponse.info.
At Regions Bank, we're here to listen to your needs and we'll customize a plan to help you reach your financial goals. Our service to Georgia goes beyond banking to creating more inclusive prosperity in our communities. From education to financial wellness to economic development, we're working to level the playing field so more people can succeed and our communities can thrive.
Welcome back to the postgame show presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to buckle up, Georgia. I'm Hannah Gooden. Let's check back in with John Nelson while we wait for more coaches to join us. And John, I've got to say, my Lassiter Trojans got the W against Wheeler tonight, 16-10. What'd Lakeside do?
I don't know. I was hoping for a little assistance in that. Perhaps check in with our buddy Mark Brock and Chris Chilton out at DeKalb County and find out what was going on
efforting.
There. Mark
efforting.
Brock and Chris Chilton, efforting DeKalb County, efforting DeKalb County Media Relations. If you would please give us the DeKalb County scores, that would be great.
Lakeside lost to Northview, 30-6.
We need the Lakeside score. Come on now.
I just told it to you. They lost to Northview 30-6.
Okay, well, okay, so we're 1-1. Morris Starr is 1-1 on the season. So they beat Berkmar and lost this week out. So we're 1-1.
And producer Lori's Blessed Trinity defeated Eagles Landing Christian 37-14.
Wow, big win for them, especially Eagles Landing Christian, Jonathan Guest leaving in the offseason to go to Hebron Christian. They had a big lead tonight. I think they were up 27-3 at one point. So it's interesting to see what the post-Jonathan Guest era is lending itself to at Eagles Landing Christian. That'll be a developing story all season long.
Yes, it will. And another developing story we have been talking about all week long is Colquitt County and new head coach Sean Calhoun. Hey, Coach, we just talked to you on Monday. Great to chat again.
Great to see you, Hannah. Thank you for having me.
You guys beat Stockbridge 29-0, and the game was stopped due to weather. Tell me about that decision.
Yes, ma'am. So we got it to halftime, and then, you know, just we looked at the weather and lightning just kept popping all around. And, you know, obviously we both wanted to play, but they still had a long drive home. And we had a 45-minute delay to start the game. So the game didn't start to about 8:15 anyway. And with it being a non-region game, you know, we just decided to just call it.
Coach, it's John. Nothing like being inside the rectangle when folks are looking at flash flood warnings and thunderstorm warnings. You know, when you have a game that starts late, goes the way that it does, ends early, what lessons can you take from this one, even though it was a 29-0 win in the books? What lessons are you taking forward from this one that you can apply to your next game?
We actually were able to apply our 2-hour lightning delay last Saturday in our first game. So I don't know if we're becoming professionals at dealing with this lightning delay, but our kids did a great job, you know, and last week really helped us out, and, you know, and they just stay upbeat and the coaches, because obviously we can't change it and can't control it. And so we just kind of keep them focused and let them be kids there for a little bit and warm them up. And it was a great atmosphere tonight in the hog pen.
Well, the rain is lucky for you because you're 2-0 with two blankings. The first one against 37-0. This one, Stockbridge, 29-0. So two blankings. Tell me about your defense and how you were able to hold off any scoring in those two rain delay games.
The defense is doing a heck of a job. You know, they're flying around. You know, we preach all the time to play fast and to play physical, and they are. So tonight, we stripped it and had a scoop and score. We had two interceptions that obviously set the offense up in great field position. And so defense is flying around and making plays, and we're playing a lot of people. So Coach Rowell and his staff is doing a heck of a job, and hopefully they can keep it up.
So, Coach, one more from me before Hannah sends you off, hopefully, to a drier locale and maybe get the chance to dry out. You know, since she asked you about your defense, let me ask about the offense. I know that you've really taken a lot of pride with the offensive line and getting the yardage that you are from the line of scrimmage. Talk about the guys up front for me and the paths that they're helping create for your running game and making sure that your QB is as protected as he's been in these first two games.
Absolutely. You know, the first game, you know, we rushed for, I think it was like 320 something yards, you know, and tonight we were a little bit more balanced throwing and rushing, didn't give up a sack, but Coach Giddens, Bryce Giddens is our offensive line coach. He's fantastic. And so that unit is really starting to gel together. We got six or seven guys that we can play. And each week that they keep playing, they're just getting better and starting to move as one, because tonight our opening drive was a 16-play drive. And so there was a handful of third downs there and handful of a third and shorts. And so times like that, you got to lean on your offensive line. So hopefully we can continue and keep getting better.
Absolutely, Coach Calhoun. You have Tift County up next week. We will definitely have our eye on that big home game for you. Thank you so much for your time again this week. I know we've chatted a lot, so we appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Y'all have a good evening.
You too. John, he was a really good guest on the podcast this week as well. Tell us about some of the stories he was saying.
Well, I mean, one of the biggest things for Sean is one of the underlying stories when it comes to Region 1-7A. And I think that that's going to be one of the fun ones as we go into region play, because you have Zach Grage at Lowndes. You have Shelton Felton at Valdosta. So you've got the Wintersville Classic with as much of a tie as it is already. Then you add Sean Calhoun to the mix. All three of them were a part of the Rush Probst staff at Colquitt County in 2014 and 2015 that won the championships. And so that to me is one of the more fun ones of the whole deal, where you have three coaches in one region from the same coaching tree. And so, yes, they're on each other's speed dial, except for the one night of the week where they're playing each other and that kind of stuff. Yes, we wish each other well, except when we're playing them. So that, to me, is one of the more fun storylines with these three guys that's attached as we look at the new Region 1-7A with the Rush Probst coaching tree and three of the biggest schools in South Georgia, three of the biggest schools with pedigrees really in all of high school football, all attached by that one man, Rush Probst, looking right there in Region 1-7A, that big triangle separated by about 45 minutes.
And Region 1-7A got shaken up this year with reclassification. Tell us about some of the new teams that joined.
Well, you've got Richmond Hill coming in. Valdosta comes up from 6A. They're a part of the new 1-7A, and you can catch the Shelton Felton interview on all of the social media platforms for GPB. But Matt Lazat is the other story in all of this, where you have Camden as a part of it with Jeff Heron. You have Lowndes and Valdosta. Valdosta coming up from 6A. You've got Colquitt, and then you have Richmond Hill. So Richmond Hill, which is basically the next exit south of Savannah, and the Eisenhower Loop, is going to have to travel. This season for Matt Lazat is, I mean, really, you want pack a lunch, pack a dinner, and maybe a midnight snack? He's got back-to-back games with Valdosta and Lowndes. So, I mean, there's no one to the other. There's no home and away. He has both of those away games this year. It's great next year because he's got them both on the hill. But this season, he has to travel back-to-back games in a three-week period to take on Lowndes and Valdosta. You want to talk about a welcome to Region 1-7A into 7A football? Matt Lazat and Richmond Hill, they've got it. They're not going to back down from the challenges this year, but it's one of the nastiest regions that I've ever seen for a first-year team jumping into it like Matt Lazat and Richmond Hill.
And, John, while we're on the topic of reclassification, what have you seen these past 2 weeks that's jumped out to you with some of the movement? Is any big surprises?
Well, I mean, I think that you look at the matchups and what sometimes you're forced to do. And what I mean by that is when you thought you had your reclassification squared away and you knew what your region was going to be, then you have the appeals process happen in the winter. Then what you thought you had, in some cases, you didn't have, and then you had to reclassify all over again. You're in another region all over again. You're in your second region when you thought you were in your first region, and then you had to almost reschedule your schedule. And so you're going to end up with some teams that thought they had an idea of who they were going to play. Then they had to kind of break that down. You know, that schedule Jenga got knocked away. And then they had to figure out who they were going to be playing second time around. And so you're having to kind of learn on the fly a little bit about scheduling and patience and all these kinds of things. And when you got your travel figured out, and then all of a sudden you've got to refigure out your travel. It's the growing pains of the appeals process of what you have when it comes to reclassification. It's just one of the lessons that we all have now.
Well, one of the biggest games tonight was a 7A showdown between Norcross and Mill Creek. We have head coach Josh Lovelady here joining us now to talk about that big win, 49-17. Coach, what was working tonight?
Well, all three facets of the game were big for us. It was a bond burn in the first quarter. It was back and forth with Norcross. They've got some great skill folks, especially on offense. A couple of defensive one guys that we were adjusting to on our end defensively, but we got our offense going, mixing in our passing game with our running game, and then a big part of our success thing tonight was our special teams. And we had seven or eight kickoffs in the end zone, and a couple of pins in the punts that we pinned them down deep. So it was some good football tonight.
Coach, it's John. Let me ask you this on grading scale, and you can take it 1 to 10 or you can take it however you want for a grading scale. Over the first two games of the season, how would you grade your offense? How would you grade your defense? And how would you grade your special teams on a scale of 1 to 10?
Well, I would probably say my special teams is right now the highlight. Early in the season, a lot of times you're finding your identity on defense. As far as we had to replace three secondary guys, and the way we put a lot of pressure on our secondary, the way we play ball, and that's how. So it's a learning curve for us there, and it doesn't help when you go against Walton and Norcross. They have such elite talent out there in the offenses. We got a lot better from week one to week two on defense. I think offensively, we were kind of that Mill Creek of the old. We're a new Mill Creek in the sense of we can throw the ball out there in space. And if we have some playmakers, then we can really rush the ball as well.
Coach, we see you're on the bus. You were away last week. You will be away again next week against Archer. How does that start the season off, being away? You will not be home until September 16th against Cedar Grove. So what kind of challenge does that pose?
Well, not being at the home, we had some issues with transportation as far as us get on a bus early because the kickoff is 7 o'clock. So not as much rest time. It's also a short week. When you play on Saturday evening and then you lose a day. So we had to trust our kids. As far as Monday was a light day for us, and I had to trust and say, let's just go on the helmets and get the game plan in. And it worked out for us. So we're trying to find our identity, but I tell you what, week in, week out, you got two opponents that were very good. And then here comes Archer too, which is a good squad.
Yeah, that's three tough teams, back to back to back to back. What bus are you on, by the way?
We're on the cheese bus. We're headed back home.
Cheese bus. I don't see anybody back there. Is everybody asleep?
Oh,
there they are. Hey, guys.
There you go.
Congratulations on the big win and for your time, Coach. Thank you so much, and be safe on that big cheese.
Will do. Thank you. I appreciate your support. High school football.
Thank you. John, the big cheese. The big cheese.
Okay, well, so that's the first time I've heard of it referred to as the big cheese. I've heard to it referred to as yellow hounds, not greyhounds, but yellow hounds. I've never heard of them as the big cheeses before. That's a first for me.
You're
so I'll
kidding.
Have to hang on to that
We've
one.
We've been calling it the big cheese forever. That's seriously the first time.
I have never heard of it as the big cheese. Never, 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 never,
oh,
never.
Man.
I've heard yellow hounds. I've heard school buses. I've heard, the county bus. But I have never heard the big cheese.
Oh, man, John. All right. Well, I am being told currently that we are announcing next week's game and we're allowed to announce next week's web game. We will be broadcasting Brookwood Broncos at Collins Hill Eagles next Friday, September 2nd at 7:30. Our web game will be a Central Georgia matchup, Northside Warner Robins versus Warner Robins, Friday, September 2nd, 7:30, simultaneously casted. And John, what were you calling this? The second screen experience?
The second screen experience, the multi-screen experience, take your pick. But you've got Northside and Warner Robins with Globetrotter Greg next week. You want to talk about a game in Middle Georgia at the MAC. I would recommend that this is another one, if you've got a free Friday night, to go to this one. The most important person in most years for this game is the fire marshal in Houston County, and I'm not kidding. Mike Davis, rest his soul, was the fire marshal, and he was also the play-by-play guy for Northside for a long, long time. He had double duty. You had like 12,000 people in one place. It is red school, it is blue school. And that's why when we did the interviews, Wes Nichols and I, when we did Central Swing, when we talked to Coach Westbrook, it was talking about the red school going up against the blue school. And when we caught up with Coach Allegood at the blue school, it was about catching up with them and the red school. This is rivalry that is unparalleled. I mean, it is right there at the top of your list, and if it's not, it should be because of the history that's attached to it. We've got it for the web game next week, your second screen experience at gpb.org, Northside and Warner Robins. It will be big.
I want to talk about Brookwood Collins Hill with you too, John. But first, we have Cedar Grove head coach John Adams waiting for us to chat. And Coach Adams, interesting, your game got canceled. It was Edison out of Miami. Tell us about what happened.
I'm honestly not sure what happened. I got a call from Miami Edison's AD Wednesday night. So he just said they couldn't get on the same page, you know, maybe as far as the county and the region. So, you know, we wasn't able to complete the game or get the game going.
So, Coach, when you're in a situation like this where game on against Miami Edison, game off, then Miami Edison's like, yeah, we'll try it again, and then it's game off again, what's that like, you know, on the sine wave of momentum and emotion for the guys, and not just for the coaches, but for the student athletes as well, where it's like game on, game off, game on, game off. What was that roller coaster like for you guys and having to sit and watch everybody else here on a Friday night?
It was just real unfortunate. The kids prepared. We actually, you know, traded film on Tuesday. Traded film on Tuesday, and you know, thought we was playing. We scheduled senior night, so it was a lot of senior festivities during the week. So just real unfortunate. It's a situation where it was kind of out of our control. So, you know, hopefully I won't be put in a situation like that again.
We certainly hope not. That is a big disappointment. You can, you know, see how frustrated you are. Well, you've got a big one on the road, Westlake, coming up next Friday. And we saw them beat Crisp County 47-7 here on GPB. They've got playmakers all over the place in quarterback R.J. Johnson, cornerback Avion Terrell, running back Jaden Thomas. How do you start preparing for a team like that?
Just taking it one day at a time. You know, we've already told the boys, you know, we're going to have a really good week of practice. They do have playmakers. They have a really good running back. RJ, the quarterback, is a three-year starter. So we're going to have to play solid football on all three phases of the game.
And, Coach, at the same time, you know, the Cedar Grove pedigree has carried itself down to Crisp with Coach Patrick and now Lawrence with what he's doing now as head coach. The Cedar Grove approach has always been, especially in the non-region schedule, we will play anyone, any place, anytime, twice on Tuesday or out on I-20 if we want to, just to play quality competition. What is it like and what has it been like for Cedar Grove to have to find opponents and challenge yourselves? Because I imagine as the success for Cedar Grove has grown, folks don't want to play you as much as they used to. How difficult is it to find opponents, yet you pair yourself in an opponent next week with Westlake, who's with that same mentality?
Definitely has been challenging this year. I think the big challenge was we only had three teams in our region. So anytime you got to go out and find seven non-region games, it's going to be tough. But, you know, the level of our program right now, you know, everybody's not knocking on our door to try to play us. So we've always taken that as a challenge. We understand the bigger picture is going to prepare us for the playoff and just prepare us. And we'll find out a lot about our team versus a lot challenging schedule. So that's why that's the making of our schedule. We want to play quality opponents that's going to help us up.
Coach Adams, you and I were just chatting at the Decatur Media Days. It feels like yesterday, already a couple of games in. Thank you so much for your time. Looks like you're heading somewhere, so please drive safe and buckle up.
All right, thank y'all. Thank y'all for having me.
Thanks, Coach. And thank you, John. John, can we get a final word?
Excellent work of the cross promotion for
yes.
The sponsor of the post game show.
I know.
Well done.
I know.
I felt that coming. Where you're sitting there and you're saying, "Buckle up, coach." Excellent way to ease the coach out so he can finish the rest of his evening, so we can sit there and ease our way out of our evening and get ready for Monday.
Yeah, exactly. He's probably like, "Why is she telling me to buckle up?" I'm obviously buckled up. Thanks, John.
Exactly. Look above her head.
Yes. Buckle Up Georgia. Thanks, Sean. Thanks for all the coaches for taking the time to call in. Thank you to everybody here in the studio and in the control room. It was a great night. We had Westlake versus Crisp County. The final score is 47-7. Next week, Brookwood, Collins Hill. Can't wait for it. Thanks for staying up late and hanging out with us. We will catch you guys next week. See you then. Thanks for watching.
Football Fridays in Georgia on GPB is presented by the Governor's Office of Highway Safety, reminding you to be safe on every trip. Buckle up, Georgia.
Sweetheart, please don't forget to wear your seatbelt.
I got it, Mom. It's a really nice day, living in the right space. Breathing your breath, got me feeling some kind of way.
Blink of an eye, so many tomorrows can disappear. Buckle up for your future.